Good morning. Welcome to the inaugural Black Research Symposium. After George Floyd's death and the world's response of solidarity and unity and a collective call for accountability and change, San Diego State University issued the 10-point plan to support the Black community. Number 8 of the plan, the university committed to organizing a research symposium to highlight and support the research and interests of Black scholars. The theme of today's symposium is When They See Us. As you may recall, this is the title of Ava DuVernay's documentary about the exonerated five. Truth matters. Representation matters. The counter narrative matters. Each paper presentation, panel, and performance resonates with this theme. To begin today's program, we'd like to welcome Jacob Alvarado Wypuk, Chair of Tribal Relations, to recite our land acknowledgement.
Hauke. Hauke I pei ma te pei cham, nos kanau ne chuki, mat I pai kumiai, my name is Jacob. I'm Ipai from San Pascual Reservation. My village is called Mokolkoch. My clan is Wypuk, means king snake. Born and raised on San Pascual Reservation. And I'm honored to be here today to say the land acknowledgement and to honor our people in a good way. We stand upon a land that carries the footsteps of millennia of Kumeyaay people. They are people whose traditional life ways intertwine with the worldview of earth and sky in a community of living beings. This land is part of a relationship that has nourished, healed, protected, and embraced the Kumeyaay people to the present day. It is part of a worldview founded in the harmony of the cycles of the sky and the balancing forces of life. For the Kumeyaay, the red and black represent the balance of those forces that provide for harmony within our bodies as well as the world around us. As students, faculty, staff, and alumni of San Diego State University, we acknowledge this legacy from the Kumeyaay and promote this balance in life as we pursue our goals of knowledge and understanding. We find inspiration in the Kumeyaay spirit to open our minds and hearts. It is legacy of the red and black. It is land of the Kumeyaay. Yechan. Machan epesho.
Thank you, Jacob. Next, we'd like to welcome the Vice President of Student Affairs and Campus Diversity and Chief Diversity Officer, Dr. Luke Wood.
Welcome, everyone, and glad to see so many smiling faces here to do and engage in some really important conversations. My name is Luke, and I have the pleasure of serving as Vice President for Student Affairs and Campus Diversity here at San Diego State University. And this symposia was originally conceptualized, as Dr. Reddick said, after the murder of George Floyd. And our campus had a number of different responses to that. First was a major change that happened with our Department of Africana Studies and our School of Public Affairs, where they came together and said, you know, the way that we're preparing police officers across the country is clearly not aligned with what we want to see. And so there was an effort that was made, and within 10 days, that effort was successful and resulted in a major policy change, which now is that for any student who is going into criminal justice beginning this fall, that they have as a requirement for their graduation, they have to take coursework on Black lives and policing so they can understand the importance of having a positive relationship with the Black community. Now that went through our university senate. So that was essentially, was the faculty's response to this. We also knew that the administration needed to have a response as well, and that no one wanted to see a statement that said we stand with the Black community or with no action that went along with it. And so there was a number of things that were announced as part of what was called the 10-point plan or the Juneteenth message that was really what was the administration's commitment to trying to improve the lives and conditions of Black people at San Diego State and in our community and in beyond. And two main things out of those 10 points that I can highlight right now. The first is this symposium. which is an opportunity for people to come together and hear about the important work that's being done in our community. We have some of the best scholars. We have some of the brightest minds in terms of students who are doing research. And so it's an opportunity for us to recognize the incredible power and talent that we already have existing within this community. The second thing was that there would be a cluster hire of a faculty who had a demonstrated record of success in either doing research, teaching, or service focused on Black and African-American populations. And initially it was said that there was going to be five that would be part of that cluster hire. Now, five may not sound like a lot, but when I started in this role, there was 25 of us who are Black faculty. So going from 25 to 30 would have been a big deal, but we also believe in under promise, over deliver. And so though it was five that was initially said, we believe that there's going to be around 12 that will have been part of this new cluster that's coming in. And so that's an incredible opportunity for our campus community. It's going to help ensure that there are more people from the Black community who can be engaging with people from all kinds of different backgrounds, including our Black students. But it also is a challenge because we want to make sure that the people that we're bringing to this institution are coming into an environment that's going to be healthy, it's going to be supportive. And so I want you all to know that we're not just bringing people in, but we're also having those departments that are doing those hiring to go through trainings themselves on anti-Blackness, racial microaggressions, bias, so we can better ensure that our faculty are going into healthy departments. I like to just close off my comments by just thanking Dr. Reddick and her team that have put on this amazing event that's today, and for being able to secure some amazing, amazing speakers, including Nikole Hannah Jones, who I know I'm personally excited to be able to see. So thank you, Dr. Reddick, for your leadership. Thank you for those of you who are part of the BRC who are involved in putting on this event. I know there's a lot of students who I'm seeing names and recognize that you were also part of helping to make this come to reality. So thank you for your hard work. And let's get into this. Black Lives Matter.
It is my privilege and honor to introduce Rudy Francisco. He is a native San Diegan. He is described as an artist who is an amalgamation of social critique, introspection, honesty, and humor, using personal narratives to discuss the politics of race, class, gender, and religion, while simultaneously pinpointing and reinforcing the interconnected nature of human existence. Now, Mr. Rudy Francisco.
Morning, everybody. First and foremost, I would like to say thank you to Dr. Reddick for inviting me here today. I think this is such an important event, and I'm really glad that I'm able to be a part of it. So I'm just gonna go ahead and jump in. I'm a spoken word artist slash poet from San Diego, California, born and raised. I'm gonna do some poems today. This first poem is actually the first poem that I ever performed, right? And it's something that I still perform to this day because I feel like it was something that was really a cornerstone of my identity at the time in which I wrote it. And I find myself revisiting it every now and then and still feeling like a lot of this is true. So here we go. I wanna write a poem, but I wanted to say what you're thinking. I wanna patch up the holes when your boat starts sinking. I wanna write that one of a kind poem, that free your mind poem, that I like how you made that rhyme poem, that I like that last line poem, that can I hear that one more time? That is, if you don't mind, poem. I wanna write that she's kind of fine poem, that I wish she was mine poem, that I wanna ask her out, but I'm on my last dime. Poem that what should I do? Please God, give me a sign poem. I want to write that so heartfelt, I think I know them poem, that this is so amazing, I want to call all my friends so I can show them poem. I want to write about everything that I've ever wanted to be, I want to write a poem so beautiful that my parents might actually start to agree. I want to write about you, about me, about us, about everything from cars and trains to riding the bus to betrayal and trust to mistakes and heartaches. I want to talk about when I first learned to drive and I was so scared to let my foot off of the brakes. I want to talk about battles, about wars, about victories and losses, about ethnic cleansing, genocide, and laws penetrated by burning crosses and burnt down churches. I want to write two poems for everyone who's ever been told they were worthless. I want my metaphors and similes to part oceans, rivers, and seas. I want to write love poems so sweet that the ink on the paper attracts honeybees. I want to speak the unspoken. I want to fix everything in the world that's broken. I want to be the one that performs the Heimlich maneuver as soon as our society starts choking. I want my words of inspiration to inspire somebody else to be inspirational. I want the motivation in my voice to motivate somebody else to be motivational. I want my phrases to be published, documented, and quoted. I want people to recite my work 10 years from now and have critics say, that was cool, but it wasn't nearly as good as he first wrote it. See, I want husbands to thank my poems for the heart that they stole. And I know this is just some shameless attempt to immortalize my soul, but honestly, I don't want to be forgotten. See, I don't need fortune. I really don't need fame. I just want people to know what I stood for and why I came. I refuse to die a mere occupant of the earth, a John Doe, another faceless man out there with no name. I refuse to be just another man. I want to walk for centuries and leave my footprints in the sand for the world to see. And I want to be cremated into ashes of rhymes and poetry. I'm just feeling like one day they're gonna love me. See, I don't share my emotions too often, but poetry will allow me to die with my heart on my sleeve. They never saw me coming, but I'll make sure they grieve when I leave. So, so I have a couple more poems. So I have about 15 minutes total, right? So this next poem that I want to dive into, it's a little bit shorter, but I've been writing shorter poems lately, right? So this poem is referred to as an obit, right? So Victoria Chang, she sort of pioneered this form where she writes obituaries, right? But they're not traditional obituaries, like they're obituaries for like things in her life that no longer exist, right? And I feel like this poem is appropriate for the time. So I'm gonna go ahead and read it. It's an obituary to my patients, right? My patients died violently on May 25th, 2020. The video of George Floyd's murder goes viral. Once again, America finds the ghost of Martin Luther King, drags it out of the basement and tells us not to retaliate in violence. They say we are an ocean looking for water. They say you don't see all this justice, all this equality, all this freedom. The flag still mispronounces your name, but it's getting closer. The bald eagle apologized for clawing at your flesh. It thought you were already dead. It's an honest mistake and nobody's perfect. They say these incidents have nothing to do with color. It's not always about race. Your ancestors would have traded spots with you in a heartbeat and we would allow them to talk long enough to call it a blessing. This country likes to wipe its mouth with our sorrow and then remind us of all the progress that we've made. Meanwhile, white privilege is somewhere pointing at a picture of Colin Kaepernick and it's laughing. Thank you. This next poem that I wanna do, I remember around the time when my videos started to get popular, I would get a lot of messages from people. And then I remember when I started talking more about my Blackness, and I would also get a lot of messages from people. And what I noticed is that I started to lose followers, right? But I also started to gain a lot of followers. But a lot of people that I was losing were the people who didn't believe that my life mattered, you know? And I remember somebody messaging me and saying, I love your poems, but I don't really like the ones where you talk about being Black. And I was like, well, you don't love my poems, you know? And she replied, she's like, no, like I do. And I was like, no, like if you don't believe that my life matters, then you can't possibly enjoy my work, you know? I was like, you can't enjoy my work and also believe that my life doesn't matter at the same time. So I started writing more about my Blackness. Yeah, this poem, I call it Adrenaline Rush. So there's this thing, right? It's called volcano surfing. It's a sport in which an individual rides down an active volcano at 50 miles per hour using nothing but a wooden board. When I first heard about this activity, I thought to myself, it must be nice to feel so safe you have to invent new ways to put yourself in danger. When the body thinks it may be swallowing its last breath, the adrenal glands release hormones into the blood. The skin becomes a cocktail of sweat and fear. The heart gets claustrophobic. The lungs become newlyweds holding hands in a crashing airplane. This is called an adrenaline rush. I was about 18 when I started driving. I was about 18 the first time I was pulled over. The officer spilled his lights all over my rearview mirror. He splashed out of his car with his hand already on his weapon. He looked at me the way a tsunami looks at a beach house, and I could tell that he's the kind of man who brings a gun to a food fight. He called me son, and I thought to myself, that's an interesting way of pronouncing boy. He asked me for my license, registration, wants to know what I'm doing in this neighborhood, if the car was stolen, if I have any drugs. And most days, y'all, I know how to grab my voice by the handle. I know how to swing it like a hammer, but instead I picked it up like a shard of glass, scared of what might happen if I didn't hold on to it carefully, because I know that this much melanin, that uniform, is a plot line to a film that can easily end with the chalk outline baptism, me trying to make a body bag look stylish for the camera, and becoming the newest coat in a closet full of RIP hashtags. Once a friend of a friend asked me why there weren't more Black people in the X Games, and I said, you don't get it. Being Black is one of the most extreme sports in America. We don't need to invent new ways of risking our lives because the old ones have been working for decades. Jim Crow may have left the nest, but our streets are still covered in its feathers. Being Black in America is knowing there's a thin line between the traffic stop and the cemetery. It's the way my body tenses whenever I hear a police siren in a song. It's the quiver in my stomach whenever there's a cop car behind me. It's the sigh of relief when I turn right and he doesn't. Being Black in America is knowing that you're not safe in a hoodie, a t-shirt, a tuxedo. Being Black in America is knowing that you're not safe in a pool, in a church, in a classroom. Hell, I don't need to go volcano surfing. I have an adrenaline rush every time an officer drives past without pulling me over. And I realize I'm gonna make it home safe. Well, you know, this time, epilogue. So she asked me to kill the spider, right? Instead, I get the most peaceful weapons I can find. You know, I take a cup and a napkin, I catch the spider, I put it outside, and I allow it to walk away. She says, why? I tell her, if I am ever caught in the wrong place at the wrong time, just being alive, not bothering anyone, I hope I'm giving the same kind of mercy. But thank you. So, I'm gonna do. I got time for one more, maybe. I think. Okay. So, I've been writing a lot about my mental health lately, and I just think it's such an important thing to do, at least like for like my own well-being. It was something that I avoided for a really long time. And I think as Black people in America, I think something that we often don't talk about as well, you know? And I found myself really avoiding the subject matter because I was going through a lot and I wasn't handling life very well at the time. So I decided that it was time for me to just sort of like write about my mental health, even if I didn't share it. You know, it was something that I just needed to do for my own well-being, because writing for me, you know, like I do it as a profession, like it's like my full-time occupation, but I also do it for myself as well. You know, it's kind of like keeping a journal. So I started writing more about my mental health, and initially I wasn't going to share these poems, but you know, what I remembered was when I first got into poetry, like I was watching other poets perform and it made me feel like I wasn't alone anymore. You know, I was like, wow, like I know how that feels, you know? And I feel like that's what made me gravitate toward this art form in the first place, because it's such a blatant and brutally honest art form, you know, because there's a writing in free verse, like you don't necessarily have to Like, you don't have to write in like a bar format, like you don't have to write in pentameter or anything like that. So to really get to be honest in ways that other forms don't really allow for. So, you know, when I saw people talking about like their struggles and what they were dealing with, you know, it made me feel like I wasn't alone, you know? So I was like, you know what, you know, if I write this poem and I share it, maybe somebody else will have that feeling as well. So yeah, here we go. I call it Drowning Fish. And this is my last poem. During the winter of 2015, the residents of Hampton Bays, Long Island, woke up to what they say was the worst smell they had ever experienced. Mysteriously overnight, 1,000 fish had died in the canal. After thorough analysis, they found that the oxygen levels in the water were too low and all the fish had drowned. Upon hearing the news, many had questions like, how does a fish drown? Don't they have gills? Don't they have a fin and a tail? They said things like, but aren't they built to survive in that environment? And perhaps this is the best analogy for my depression. This angry deity, this jealous god, this thirsty shadow that wrings my joy like a dish rag, turns every conversation into a conveyor belt that always begins with the phrase, you look tired today. To be honest, getting out of bed has become a magic trick and I'm probably the worst magician I know. This sadness is the only clean shirt I have left and my washing machine has been broken for months. When people ask me how I'm doing, I want to say that my daughter's 5 years old and I'm still not sure if I'm a good father. I want to say that my dad has been diagnosed with dementia. There might be a day when I walk in the room and he doesn't recognize me and I've always wanted us to start all over, but I guess you got to be careful about what you ask for. I guess when you pray for something, you have to be a little more specific. I want to say that crickets have been known to eat their own wings and I too have a tendency to destroy what helps me get off the ground. I really want to say that I'm not in a good place right now, but that's not a polite answer. So instead I pretend it's Halloween, I jack-o'-lantern my face into something acceptable, and I tell others I'm fine until it sounds like the truth. But sometimes there's a help me chained to the ankle of an I'm doing okay. Sometimes I'm fine is the quickest way to say I don't want to talk about it. Sometimes all the oxygen in the room becomes water. I feel like I'm sinking to the bottom, like I'm running out of air, but I made a promise to myself that I won't be another drowning fish, that I will not die in this canal. I heard that if you just take a deep breath and relax, the human body will naturally float on top of the water. So I breathe and I tell myself that it's gonna be okay. I cry, but I tell myself that it's gonna be okay. It's gonna be okay. It's gonna be okay, because I know there's a better version of me somewhere in the future. He is staring at this moment right here and he is saying, Rudy, thank you for not giving up on us. So yeah, a few days ago while I was reading, I came across a run-on sentence and I thought, you know, like it could have just ended right there, but it found a reason to keep going. I smiled and I said, same. Well, thank you so much. That is my time today. Thank you so much, San Diego State. Like, I love your institution. I've spent a lot of time on your campuses throughout the years. Y'all were some of the first people who believed in me and offered to like pay me for gigs and stuff. So this is a really, really beautiful opportunity for me to be able to do this for y'all. Thank you so much. That is my time today.
Wow, thank you so much, Mr. Francisco. These were absolutely powerful and this was the most amazing way to start the day and just to prepare us for everything else that we're gonna be hearing today. Thank you so much for blessing us with your beautiful words. So our morning workshops begin promptly at 10 a.m. The 10 to 10:30 workshops are Dr. Luke Wood et al., Black Boys and Suspension Rates, Dr. Tanika Green and Dr. Nikole Belisle, African-American Mentorship Program Alumni Experiences, Tamio McKee Bay, Mentorship Practice of African-American Women. The 10:30 to 11 workshops are Mary Jones, Oakland Black Panther Party, Seth Malios, The Story of Nathan Harrison, Azure Fisher, The Black Plague, Long-Term Impacts of COVID-19. And the 10 to 11 session is Dr. Reddick and Aaliyah Chambers, African-American Academic Success Programs. Please locate the breakout rooms at the bottom of the screen and join the workshop of your choice. If you have a 30-minute workshop, feel free to join the one-hour session when your session concludes. And we will meet everyone back in the main session at 11 for our keynote speaker, Nikole Hannah Jones. Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning. Sorry. I forgot to connect with you. Hi, Maya. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing well. Oh my God. Rudy Francisco was an excellent choice. Amazing. Oh my God. He's amazing.
Mm-hmm. I was so excited.
He's amazing. Good. That was a good choice, Sierra.
I knew he would be great. It's just exciting to see him in person, kind of.
Yeah. And I write poetry, but I can't ever recite it from memory. Mm-hmm. He recited his very first poem and it was long.
Right. Knew the whole thing.
Yes, that was amazing. Good morning. Okay, my co-host just told me I need to share the screen. So give me 1 second to figure this out. Oh, what was that? Okay, I'm going to share my screen. Okay. Can everyone see this screen?
Yep, we're all good.
Okay, awesome. Thank you so much for joining us in this workshop entitled We Persist, We Persevere, We Don't Give Up. And it is a exploration of African-American academic success programs, specifically the one that we developed here at San Diego State University. So before we begin the presentation, I want to give you a sense of what Black students experience at this predominantly white institution. I'm going to ask you if you will join me in a game of Kahoot. So if you would join Kahoot, and the pin is on the screen. How are we looking? Is everybody that, I can't see the screen, says everyone that wanna join, have you all joined? Okay, I'm going to assume that everyone has that wants to play is on. So we'll go ahead and get started. Okay, so San Diego State is comprised of 7 colleges. And Dr. C. Moe is on top. When was San Diego State founded? Okay, and I hope that the two that got that answer correct are students here. So San Diego State was founded in 1897, started as a teacher's college. Dr. C. Moe still on top. How many degree programs does San Diego State have? San Diego State has 195 degree programs. Oh, Dr. C. Moe is on fire. Spring 2018, how many students graduated from San Diego State? Okay, 2 people know. Okay, 10,000 students graduated from San Diego State. So I want you to pay attention to these numbers. Okay, I don't think anybody's going to catch you, Dr. C. Is the Division of Academic Engagement and Student Advancement one of SDSU's 7 colleges? Oh. Let's see if Dr. C. Moe still. Oh.
Well, I got that one wrong.
I'll have to see who this CMO is that is accurate in this information. How many Black male freshman students applied to San Diego State for admission fall 2019? How many applied? 1,200. Pay attention to that number. 1,200 Black male freshmen applied for admission. Okay, Simo, you still on top. How many of those men were admitted? So 1,200 applied, how many were admitted? So we started with 1,200 applied, 325 were admitted. How many actually enrolled? Of that 325, how many actually enrolled? We started with 1,200. That applied. 325 were admitted. Only 100 of them actually enrolled. We've got to improve those numbers. You being dethroned. Okay, doctor's on top. All right, let's see. Come on, my SDSU students. Don't let these folks show you up. Let's go. How many Black female freshmen applied? Remember, there were 1,200 men, so how many Black women applied? 1,900. Dr. C. Moe, that you didn't get that one?
I didn't get that one.
Okay, 1,900 applied. I was not going to give it. I guess it didn't change, huh? Okay. How many were admitted of that 1,900? How many were admitted? Now let's see how many actually enrolled. Okay, Dr. I see Mo, I think.
Yeah. That's all right. We got some more questions left.
How many actually enrolled of the 340? How many actually enrolled? Okay, so over 3,000 Black students were admitted, close to 1,000. Over 3,000 were applied, close to 600 were admitted, but only 260 enrolled. We've got to do better. Okay, Doctor. Fall 2019, there were a total of how many Black SDSU students? Fall of 2019, all Black students. Look at that number, 1,300 Black students, San Diego State's campus. 1,300, remember that number. Dr. Simo, I don't know if you can come back.
I'm running out of questions.
How many tenured faculty does San Diego State have? Tenured faculty, 800. Okay, that's all faculty, 800. How many Black faculty? 800 total. There's 30 Black faculty. It's not looking good, Simo. Fall 2018, how many total students enrolled at San Diego State? Okay, so there's 36,000 students. You guys remember how many Black students? Anyone remember?
2,000? What was it?
1,300 Black students. Of the student population. That number has not changed in decades. What happened, Doctor?
Back on top. Simo's back on top.
Simo is back on top. Got the flame and everything. Was 2021 Associated Students President a Black man? True or false? Absolutely, finally. Okay, yes. Christian Amwuka was our Associated Student President last year. Oh, you're still up there. Two more questions. What is the Campus Organization for Black Identified Students called? Yes, okay, this is the African Student Union. The African Student Union. Simo's still on top. What is the freshman mentoring program called? Okay, I hope our two HGS scholars got that one. All right, Sierra, come on. You got
this is it. Last question.
Okay, come on, Sierra, you can get it. James Brown once said, say it loud, I'm Black and I'm proud. Yeah, that was too easy. Maya.
Oh! Dang. Where'd she come from? Out of nowhere.
Yes. All right. See.
I don't know.
Era dethroned. See Mo.
Well, my daughter's a high school senior, and we are actually taking a trip down to San Diego next week. She's got to make her decision. It's going to be between San Diego State, San Marcos, and USD.
You want to? She wants to come here.
She wants. Yeah. She, okay.
Yeah. Give me a call. I'll give her an informal tour.
Oh, yeah?
I'm serious. Yes, I will. I gave a couple of students an informal tour yesterday.
I think we're going to be down on the 17th.
Okay. I'll get your information. I'm serious. You saw our numbers, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, we need Black students. And it's a good place for Black students, and I'm going to tell you why. So, you know, the academic success programs at colleges and universities can be tied to right after Dr. Martin Luther King's death and the convergence of the Black Panther Party. It is the Black Panther Party that pushed this nation into creating Black Studies program, African-centered curriculum, and admitting Black students on campuses. So once there was some cultural capital on predominantly white institutions, colleges and universities started creating these academic success programs. So they were not always called academic success programs. They were mentoring programs and a variety of other names, but the impetus for them was to ensure that Black students persisted until they earned their degree. The problem with the academic success programs historically, and even it is still true today, is that a majority of them are, the foundation of them is a deficit approach. So most of the academic success programs are built to mediate what the institution perceives as a deficit in Black students. And so it's focused on remediation of math and English. And so there are some programs, for example, Fullerton developed a program, at least initially, that was targeting Black male athletes because they were attracting Black male athletes to the school, but they weren't graduating. So they started an ambassador program for Black males, and they found that when Black males got into community with other Black men, they performed well academically and persisted. And so our program at San Diego State, the foundational principle of our program is Afrocentricity. And Afrocentricity in its simplest form is centralizing the lived experiences of Black students, okay? And so our students in the Henrietta Goodwin Scholars Program are taught by Black faculty, supported by Black mentors. And in the first semester, they take an Africana Studies class. And every Friday, they meet in a seminar class where they get in community with other Black scholars. Okay, so you saw the numbers earlier, right? There's 36,000 students at San Diego State. A little over 1,000 of them are Black. And so what our aim is to teach our students that it is okay to be Black, that you don't have to change who you are to be successful in life. In fact, I submit that you're more successful when you're comfortable in your own skin. So one of the things that our students experience on this campus at times is isolation. They experience microaggressions, which Dr. Chandra Gill told us a couple of weeks ago, there's nothing small about racism. But we give them the tools to deal with those issues in the classroom, in the dorms, and in the campus generally. And we do that because we work together. We work on ensuring that our students have a sense of belonging, that they know that they are part of our village, and that we love and support them, and we will provide them with the resources that they need to be successful. More importantly, to ensure that they persist until they earn the degree. Another thing that the research tells us is that when students are exposed to the myriad of campus resources available to them, they perform better. So if you read the qualitative research on Black students who go to the university, do not perform well and drop out, it's primarily because they weren't aware of resources that could have helped them. That's why HGS exists. That's why the BRC exists, because we make sure that our students are very aware of those resources, and we connect them with those resources to make sure that they have everything they need to be successful. The other thing that we have discovered is that intrusive counseling works. And that is, you know, a text, an email is not sufficient. We meet with our students weekly, not just in the seminar class. Our academic coaches meet individually with their mentees once a week, and then they have village meetings with their group of mentees once a week, so that students get exposed to not just a sense of belonging, but you know, they have somebody to go to campus org meetings with, or campus events, or you know, a football game or something like that, so that they don't get homesick, they're not isolated, and they always know that there are different people that they can count on. So we know that this works, and it's the foundational principle of our program. So the Dream Team, which we have labeled ourselves, we started in these positions 2 years ago and totally revamped our academic success program with the foundation of Afrocentricity. And our model is the mantra for not just the HGS program, but for the BRC and our staff, is that teamwork makes the dream work. So although we are the Dream Team, so we're the, I'm the director of the Black Resource Center, Aaliyah Chambers is the assistant director, and Dr. Tanika Green is the faculty scholar. Our staff has as much input into our programming as we do. The thing that makes us work is everybody contributes. And so even in this Black Research Symposium, staff primarily planned it, you know, with Sierra's suggestion to get Rudy Francisco. She reached out to him. So they have as much investment in this working as we do. And that's what makes it work, okay? Because we model what we want to see in our students. And I just want to give you just a taste of what HGS is and what our students experience.
HGS, yes.
HGS, yes. Come on.
What's up, y'all? This is the home of Black Excellence Scholarship and HGS.
The it's a beautiful day to be back in the BRC. We're going to talk a little bit about our HDS program and give y'all some insight on what this family is all about. Let's get into it.
What is HDS, Dr. Reddy?
So HDS is an academic success program for Black freshman students. It is designed to help them transition from high school to college. More importantly, it partners them with an academic coach that works with them on managing their schedule, studying, any conflict resolution, and building community with other students.
2.0 builds upon that because it's more of a focus on career development. And so we continue to support those students from that first year into the second year.
Every semester, students have to do an academic success plan. So we want them to look at not only short-term goals, but long-term goals. We also do a genogram because we want to connect their collegiate experience to their family experience. No one goes on this journey alone. And the success in this program is also the success of those unknown, unnamed Black people that have sacrificed for them to be in the places that they are right now.
This is just a glimpse of why we're HGSES.
Here's what some of our students and coaches have to say about the program.
HDS has helped me upgrade my experience because it has gotten me more used to my campus, learning that there are resources that are out there that are just at my disposal that I have to tap into.
It's the place where we can all just come together and learn together, grow together, be just unapologetically Black together. It's the place where we can all grow as people.
And the reassurance that there's always somebody there that got your back. Like your dream team is just there for you and they want to see you succeed.
Being a part of Harambe my freshman year was one of the greatest experiences I've ever had coming into college. And just being able to come in as an HDS mentor, as a coach, I feel like it's the most rewarding thing that I can do.
It really had a major impact on my college development in my first year. So I wanted to emulate that for other students and give back to students like it had been done to me before. So entering into this role was an easy decision because I knew that I could give a lot to students and the students can give a lot to me.
I am a leading scholar. I will persist. I will persevere. I will not give up. I am because we are. We are because I
am. HGS, yes, because we got your back.
HGS, yes, because teamwork makes the dream work.
HGS, yes, because together we are revolutionary. Together we are history in the making.
This is our community. This is our family. We are
HGS, yes! Yes!
For information, you can check out our Instagram at SDSUBRC, or you can email us at brc@sdsu.edu, or you can check out our website.
So that video was produced by one of our students. They graduated last year. Her name is Aisha Kosaka, who really refined her storytelling and video skills in the BRC. And she continues to come back and give back, continuing to tell and memorialize our stories. So she did a really good job, illuminating the importance of HGS. So as the video explained, the pillars for our program are academic success. 80% of our students earn a 3.0 or above, Black identity development and community building. They get the Black identity development in the seminar class, community building in the seminar class, and also in their village meetings. The scholars have to recite HGS affirmation every time we meet. And part of that affirmation compels them to persist, to persevere, to lean in, and not give up. So Dr. Simo, I hope you take this information because I'm already claiming your daughter. We would love to have her as an HGS scholar. She would have to apply and the information is there. The deadline is May the 5th. And then right before we have our panel discussion, just a another plug, the BRC last year in supporting our incoming freshman students had a summer bridge experience. It was, they did not earn academic credit. It was totally voluntary. It was a 3-week program. We met for 4 hours a day. But they showed up, they did work, and they were very committed. But one of the things they said is it was very valuable to them, but they would have liked it better had they earned academic credit, which I certainly agree with that. So this year we are offering the Black Scholar Summer Connection, and Black students can earn seven academic credits. They'll take 2 Africana Studies classes and a seminar class. So I just wanna talk a little bit about the Black Scholar Summer Connection, and then we'll go into our panel discussion.
Hey, what y'all excited about SDSU? I don't even know where to start.
Girl, I don't know about you, but I'm ready to turn up, okay?
What about you? I want to be part of the connection.
The connection.
For the Black Scholar Summer Connection.
Hi, I'm Dr. Bonnie Reddick, and I am the director of the Black Resource Center, and the Dream Team chooses you to be a part of the Black Scholar Summer Connection. Come with me and learn all about it. So, the Black Scholar Summer Connection is designed to help you transition to college curriculum. You will also earn academic credit. You will be enrolled in 2 Africana Studies courses, Africana Studies 170A, which is a history course, and Africana Studies 102, which is a course that critiques multi-generational trauma. In addition, you'll be enrolled in a 1-unit seminar course, which is designed to build community with other BSSK scholars.
So the pillars for the program include helping students move from a fixed to a growth mindset, racial identity development, building community with one another, as well as building some strategies for academic success, including some time management skills, collaborating with classmates, as well as meeting with professors.
Each week, students meet with their academic coach, answer any questions they have about college, join any organizations, then get the academic support as well. So if they have questions about their homework, tests, quizzes, we're here to answer any of those.
So you might be wondering why you should join the Black Scholar Summer Connection. First thing is you get to build community with other Black scholars. The second reason is the Summer Connection helps you understand the rigor of college curriculum. You have academic coaches who assist you with time management, study skills, taking copious notes, and building study groups, which is very important in your college experience. And probably the most important part of the Summer Connection is racial identity development. We have found that students that are connected in the summer maintain those connections in the fall, and our students do very well academically because they've built a community before they've ever come to the college campus.
So basically, the few classes that we have to take are great so that way I don't lose all my skills over the break, And then also the connections of, to all the resources that we get, like the Dream Team, amazing.
Oh, yeah. I'm doing that.
That's right. Where's everybody at?
Dr. C. Mo, there's more information on BSSK. There is an application for that as well. So I hope you notice at the end of that video, we end every program at the BRC with our signature song. As soon as I hear that song come on, I gather as many students as I can find. I make them go out in the backyard. They don't think I can shake a leg, but once that song comes on, everybody is out there because we are there to celebrate one another. We want them to do well academically, but we also want them to have fun. Okay. Cause that's what we're about as well. So, if you ever come to the BRC and you hear that song come on, you know, head to the backyard or Dr. Red is coming after you. So I'm going to turn over this part of the panel to my assistant director, Aaliyah Chambers. It's all on you, Aaliyah.
Awesome. Good morning, everyone. I'm like Dr. Eddick says, my name is Aaliyah Chambers, and I currently serve as the assistant director at the Black Resource Center. And I oversee our Henrietta Goodwin Scholar 2.0 program for our sophomore students. But that's enough about me. I do want to give you all an opportunity to hear from our students directly. And so on today's panel, we have Sierra Watkins, Elijah Hunter, Ryan Pitts, Shaki Moore, and Maya Taylor. And so I do want to give them an opportunity to introduce themselves, say what year you are, and maybe what your major on campus as well. And also mention what programs you've been involved with the BRC. So whether it's, you know, the Summer Bridge, HGS 2.0, et cetera. And we'll start off with Sierra.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Sierra Watkins. I am a second year theater arts major with an emphasis in performance. I am an academic coach for the Henrietta Goodwin Scholars Program. I was a mentor for the Summer Bridge program, and I'm also in HGS 2.0.
Awesome. Elijah?
Hello, my name is Elijah Hunter. I'm a freshman here at San Diego State. I haven't worked any of the programs because I just got here, but I participated in Summer Bridge. I'm in the HGS program, and I also applied to be a mentor for the BRC. So that's what Sierra's doing and Shaki and them. So yeah, I applied to do that. And I'm currently a computer engineering major, but I'm changing that soon to, I don't really know yet. I'm still thinking about it, but I think marketing or something like that. So yeah, that's me.
Awesome. Thank you, Elijah. Ryan?
Hi, my name is Ryan Pitts. I'm currently a freshman and I'm a business entrepreneurship major. I live on the Black Excellence floor. I've taken part of the Summer Bridge experience and I'm also part of the HGS program. And I'm like Elijah, I've also applied to be a HGS mentor next year.
Awesome. Maya?
Hi, everybody. My name is Maya Taylor. I am a first-year public administration major. I'm a part of the HGS program. I also lived on the Black floor for a little bit, and I also applied to be a mentor next year.
Awesome. We got a lot of folks who wanted to come back to HGS.
And what did you just do, Maya?
What, recently?
Yeah.
Oh, was recently elected to be student support representative in Associated Students.
Yes.
Congratulations, Maya. And last but definitely not least, Shaki Moore. Go ahead.
Hello, everyone. My name is Shaki Moore. I'm a second year communications major. Right now, I sit as an academic coach for the Henrietta Goodman Scholars, as well as I was a mentor for the Summer Bridge Experience and a scholar in HGS as well my freshman year.
And?
And I recently just, as my state, like Maya, I recently got elected for Vice President of External Relations of Associated Students.
You guys hear that?
Yeah, let's go.
Yes. Say it, Chris. If he won't celebrate himself, I'm going to celebrate you for you. That's big news, Shaki. Annie interviewed Ben Crump last night. Our students are doing big things. Sorry, Aaliyah. Okay, I'm gonna be quiet.
No, you're totally fine. You're totally fine. Okay, so we'll get into the panel. My first question is for, let's go to, Elijah, Ryan, or Maya, either of you can answer it, but do you feel like your K through 12 education prepared you for university curriculum?
I can speak to that. I think I have a unique experience that few others get. I think that my parents pushed me to utilize my K through 12 experience to the best that I could, but I don't think that the system does promote its best resources and things like that. So you have to go out of your way to know about AP programs and special programs that you could use to advance yourself in your education. But thankfully my parents were into all that and forced me to do that. But I know that there's a lot of other students who don't even know about programs like that that could prepare you for school. So then no, they're not prepared at all. You come to college and it's a complete shock with the workload and the study habits that you need to maintain in order to succeed. But personally, I think I was prepared. So, and also I think the Summer Bridge program does give you a little taste of what college life is going to be by interacting in a sometimes a lecture setting or getting to know your professors and just knowing like the different important aspects of college and what it takes to succeed.
Thank you. Elijah, did you want to add to that at all? What do you think the benefits of participating in the Summer Bridge last summer was for you?
Personally, I feel like just getting to know all the faculty first off, establishing a relationship with you guys, that part was kind of important because you guys have helped me like so far during the year. And if I didn't do the Summer Bridge program, I wouldn't have had that help. Also, like getting to know my friends, like the friends I hang out with now at school, like from the first day I got on campus, I had friends because of the Summer Bridge program. So I hang out with in the Summer Bridge program, Ryan was in it, Kylie was in it. So we would just knock on each other's door because we all lived on the black floor and just go get food or whatever. So that helped me transition to school easier. And then also the older kids, the sophomores like Shaki, Sierra, all of them that also worked the program. Like it was nice having friends that have been there before and you could ask for help and leading to. And so, yeah, I feel like the Summer Bridge program made it easier to transition into school, especially because I was the only person from my high school to come here. So it just made it easier.
It's awesome to hear. Maya, my next question is for you. What were your expectations for the Henrietta Goodwin Scholars Program?
So I personally didn't know what I was expecting. Like I was told there'd be a seminar class. I was like, okay, a seminar, you learn about campus resources, you get to know like other faculty working there. I was like, okay, cool, whatever. But HDS has absolutely blown those minimal expectations out of the water. The sense of community is probably my favorite part. Like I've never had this opportunity in a college setting. In an academic setting, I mean, because, you know, I went to a super small high school, it was the only one in my town. I graduated from high school in Arizona. Weren't a lot of Black people down there where I lived. So being able to come to college and have HGS is like my backbone helped me to do all the things I'm doing today because I wouldn't have never taken this initiative to get as involved as I am without HGS.
Awesome. And do any of the panelists want to speak to how has mentoring in HGS or HGS 2.0 helped you?
I'll speak to that. It's really been, the reason why I really applied to be an HDS mentor is because of my mentor my freshman year, which was Traviana. Like, she really helped me be able to, like, develop into the person that I was, who I am still developing into, because she just instilled, like, good things. Like, she was the first person to tell me about Google Calendar and, like, in college and how important that is. So I really wanted to apply to give back to other students. And just through this process, like, having, like, a mentee like Elijah, who's on the panel too, it's just been great. Like, being able to be, like, I am mentoring them, but I want them to more look at to me as a friend. Like, okay, I can come to him about anything, I can talk to him about anything, and that's kind of the relationship that me and Elijah built. So I've just been able to learn from him, and then also just, like, not even a direct mentor, but Maya. Like, I was at the Turtle Pond one day, and I seen Maya, and she was talking about associated students in the FLEX program, and that was the program that I was in last year. So I'm like, oh, you gotta apply for this, like, you know, this is what it would give to you. And now look at her doing big things. So it's just like, all of that is rewarding to see that, okay, of course she did that, but it's like me being able to say this little thing helped her in her path. So that's just rewarding to me as well.
Thank you, Shaki. Sierra, can you speak to, HGS encourages students to get involved in campus organizations. How have you yourself gotten involved?
Being in HGS really pushed me to, like, be involved on campus and, you know, be involved in the Black community, especially. So ways I've been involved, I'm a part of the SDSU Diamonds Major at Dance team on campus. So that's been a really big piece of, you know, getting to know more people and getting to dance, which is something that I love to do. And then being in HGS has really helped me, like, build up my confidence. And Dr. Reddick tells us all the time, like, knowing who we are and staying in our truth. And I'm a theater major. And so I knew, like, on campus, there wasn't a lot of representation for Black people in theater. There's not a lot of us in the department. So I and a couple other Black theater majors came up with making our organization Black Renaissance, which is our new Black theater organization on campus. And I am the co-founder and vice president of Black Renaissance. And the Black Resource Center has just been just a big help in, like, helping us evolve as an organization. And without HGS, it would have never pushed me to even want to make this organization and make this space for representation for Black people in theater, television, and film. So HGS has really just pushed me to be my best self and excel and succeed.
Awesome, thank you. And my next question is, one of the pillars of the HGS program is racial identity development. And particularly, I kind of want to hear from Elijah and Ryan, being that last summer was, you know, there was a lot going on in the country with the murder of George Floyd and you all being involved in the Summer Bridge program. Can you all speak to how maybe the HGS or Summer Bridge may have impacted your racial identity development?
Ryan, I'll go first. Okay. So me, I'm raised in, like, the most northern part of the Bay Area. So if anybody in here knows where that is, I'm from Santa Rosa. I don't know if you guys know where Santa Rosa is, but there's a bunch of races of people except for Black people. So it's basically all races except for Black people. So, like, growing up, I went to a private school too for sports reasons. So I've been raised around white people my whole life. So just even just that one transition from going from all white people to all Black people itself just kind of helped me, like, because I'm mixed. I don't know if you guys can tell. So, like, mixed people by themselves always have, like, identity issues. Like, you don't know which one is which, like, which one you should identify as because you're not too white. You're not Black enough to be with the Black people all the time. So just, like, going from the switch to all white people to all Black people made it that much easier to fully, like, accept myself as a Black man in this country, especially after what was going on in the summer. Because until then, I didn't really know who I was, but, like, just seeing people that look like me being killed over and over and over on the news screen after summer or school was already out, and I didn't have to see, like, the same white people every day, it kind of just, like, like woke me up, like those people, like that's me. So like just going from seeing people get killed to join the Summer Bridge program and then hearing like being taught by Black professors with Black students, like that part was school itself. And then going to HGS and all the assignments we have to do where they teach us every week about like people like not Black historians, but important people in Black history that we aren't taught during school, like not MLK or Rosa Parks, but like people like the first black basketball player at school or the first Black pilot, like stuff like that, that we aren't taught in schools. Like stuff like that was what kind of helped me embrace myself. So yeah, that part was cool.
I would also add to that, like I went to a primarily white school for high school. So when the beginning of like the Black Lives Matter movement and all the civil unrest, I was with white people when all that was happening. And so it was very, very silent. We never heard, none of my white teachers mentioned anything about it. And if it wasn't for social media, I probably wouldn't have known anything because they weren't telling us in school. But then since that civil unrest lasted through the summer and through the HGS program, that was one of the first topics that we were speaking about. They asked us immediately, how do you feel about all of the things that are going on in this country? And that was the first time I realized like how mad it made me. Some people were like used to say like they thought I hated white people because I was just so angry at it. But like the HGS program really just or the Summer Bridge program really made me be able to express myself, and it made me feel comfortable to express my opinions, and that it was okay for me to be as mad as I was, and that it's important for me to go out and do civil work and go to protests and things like that. And just so I knew that I was not alone and I was not the only one who was feeling this way. So that definitely helped. And also I was able, this was the first time I was ever involved with as many Black people as I was in one place. It felt so good to see so many smart Black people all in one place, because my friends used to tell me like, oh, you're so whitewashed because you're in all the AP classes. And I was just like, why do I have to be whitewashed to be smart? Like, so it felt so good to be around all these other Black people who were getting 4.0s and who are in the AP classes and who were scoring high on tests. That was just really uplifting altogether.
Awesome. Thank you both. And Maya, how has HGS helped you persist at a predominantly white institution?
So the biggest thing is this year obviously was not a year like anyone expected. Like I didn't expect my freshman year to be spent on Zoom. But HGS has helped me persist through getting involved, because right now I'm involved in things that I wouldn't have seen myself doing. Like I applied to Rotaract and I was one of 13 students to get in. I was the only freshman to get in. So HGS helped me to do that, because I wouldn't have had the power to go into that space. As Shaki mentioned earlier, I'm part of the first year leadership experience through Associated Students. There are only 5 of us. So I was one of 5 students to get into that. And I have the ability to be mentored by the current Associated Students, Christian Holt, who's also Black. So just being exposed to these spaces, I also got to go lobby with California legislatures through the California Higher Education Student Summit, one of 13 to get into that too. So HGS empowers me to do these things, because I know that I'll be able to come back to class on Friday during HGS time, say what I did, and everybody's there supporting me. And that means the world, because having a community of people who are high achieving, striving for Black excellence, and we're all celebrating each other to achieve that Black excellence means the world to me. And I couldn't be doing anything I'm doing today without the support of everybody in HGS.
Awesome. Thank you, Maya. And congratulations. I'm like, you are very humble, because some of that stuff I did not know about, but congrats, you're doing it. Awesome. My next question is directed towards Shaki and Sierra. So talking a little bit about HGS 2.0 and how it's designed to get sophomore students to start thinking about their career. Can you talk about maybe 1 to 2 things that HGS has HGS 2.0 has compelled you to think about more seriously?
I can start. HGS 2.0 really helped me think about seriously about grad school and also about
interviewing. Like our last class, we did like a little mock interviews, and that's helped me a lot because I think it's important to practice so that when we do go into these interviews, we're prepared and we're ready. And that's what HES 2.0 students are going to be. We're all going to be prepared because we have been given these tools from HES 2.0 that we can take into the real world, like we can take into our career, and they can follow us and help us develop and grow. So those are two things that HES 2.0 has given me.
Thank you. Shaki, would you like to add anything?
Yes. So HES 2.0, like, it really has me taken serious. Like, I knew I wanted to get like an internship and things like that. But then when you hear people like, HES 2.0 puts us in front of people like Deloitte and people that really are just helping you, trying to get your professionalism up and be able to conduct yourself in high-level interviews, high-level meetings, and things like that. So it just took me, it just took, gave me an opportunity to understand that professionalism is key, and like in any space that you walk into, you need to hold yourself to that that standard to be able to get a job anywhere, because if you're not holding yourself to a certain standard, then anybody that looks at you is not going to like think of you as, oh, I can hire him for a job. So like just understanding that every space you walk into, you could find a job opportunity. So hold yourself with that level of professionalism.
Awesome, thank you. And we are ending the near of our time, because I do want to give folks time before we get into our keynote session. But for our panelists, is there any final words or thoughts? Our last question is, would you recommend these programs to incoming students? So maybe if you all have any final thoughts and then can answer that question as well. I'll start with Sierra.
Yeah, direct all your comments to Dr. Simo right there. His daughter's still having to make a decision.
Well, I can tell you right now, definitely. HES 2.0, they're amazing programs. Like, and being in HES, like my freshman year, is what really impacted me to want to work at the Black Resource Center and be a mentor, because it's just such a blessing and an experience to be mentored and to be helped by these people that care and these people that look like you. Like, that's just so important. And I really would just compel your daughter to just really see that we care. We're a great community. We're going to help each other. We always build each other up. We always support each other no matter what. And that's all in our affirmation that we say every single day, like we lean into each other. And that's what's so important about these programs, because we're gonna help each other succeed because we know we can, and we have people behind us that are gonna get us through it.
And then I'll just add on to that as well, because coming to SDSU, like I come from like the Fairfield area. So it's really a melting pot of different cultures and things like that. So when I first got on campus, I just seen a boatload of white people. And I was like, oh yeah, I don't know about this. I was like, I do not know about this. I don't see any black people. Like, Harambe weekend fooled me, all of that, right? So then, when I got into HGS, and then I started going to like just HGS, and then just going to the BRC, I realized that this is my community. It gave me a space to really just be able to vocalize all my opinions and stuff like that without being judged or criticized. And then as those months went on, I just stopped seeing white people. Like, they were still there, but it was just phased out. Oh, I'm seeing more black people. Oh, I see Sierra at the union. Oh, I see Ryan in the library. Like, all of those things are just things that naturally come from HGS and the BRC. It's like, I always use the word Harambe, because like what Sierra was saying, it means working together. And we all work together. While we are 4% on this campus, we have had two consecutive black AS presidents out of the 4%. And now I'm a vice president out of the 4%. Maya is a rep out of the 4%. So these are all things that come from HDS and come from the Black Resource Center by leaning into our professors and leaning into our mentors and things like that. So these programs, I don't know what I will be without these programs.
I would also like to add on to that. I was literally just saying how I've had so many opportunities from HDS that I don't think I would have had, especially being in the time of a pandemic. Like, I just the fact that I'm able to speak on a panel like this time last year, I still didn't really know where I was gonna go to school. And now I'm speaking on a panel to a bunch of SDSU prospects. I just think that's so amazing. And I definitely wouldn't have had that opportunity if it wasn't for Dr. Reddick and the other members of the Dream Team who I've met through the programs that I've taken part in. And to Dr. CJ or Christopher Morris, I would just love to be a mentor to your daughter if she came. So there's always that. So I look forward to seeing all of you guys next year.
My ladies first. Go.
Oh, thank you. I know we're on a time crunch, but obviously, yes, I recommend HDS because, as I stated, I won't go over it again. HDS empowered me to do all of these things, and I know I have this community at my back. And that is so important, especially at SDSU when we only are 4%, because that 4% is strong, and that's shown through this program.
They all already said the good stuff, so I'm just going to kind of summarize it. HDS has been really cool for me because, like I said, like, I'm finally surrounded by people that look like me, but, like, that's, like, comforting, but it's also, like, motivating because I'm competitive, so I want to make sure that I'm succeeding. I'm not going to just be in the program just to be in the program. Like, I'm going to be in the program to make sure I'm succeeding. Every week, they make, like, we not brag, but we just show off the good grades we got the prior week, so it's just motivating. Like, not only is it comforting to be around people that look like you and that you come close with, but it also motivates you to be a better student, so. Yeah, HDS is a great thing to be a part of.
Yes, awesome. Well, thank you, especially to our panelists. Sierra, did you want to add something?
Yes, I just wanted to add one quick little thing, like just to mention to Dr. Morris, like, we have our HDS program and our HDS2 programs that, you know, really build us up and help us and are there to support us, as well as the Dream Team, who's also there to support us. And we also have the AAAC, who's there to support us as well. So that's something I wanted to get in there and mention, that our African-American alumni are also there to support us. So make sure you mention that to your daughter as well, that if she comes to San Diego, when she comes to San Diego State, she will have the biggest community to support her and just help her be the best she can be.
Awesome. So hopefully, you know, Chris Morris, that helped you with your decision, helped convince your daughter a little bit. But thank you all again. Dr. Reddick, do you have any final remarks before we head into our keynote?
No, my heart is full. My students are amazing. Brilliant. I'm so proud of you all. Dr. Simo, no pressure.
No pressure. Just a little bit.
Just a little bit.
Thank you all for joining us.
Okay, we'll see you at the next session. Take care.
We leave.
Welcome back, everyone. I hope that you all enjoyed the workshops that you just attended. When we imagined the brilliance of Black scholarship and creativity, we immediately thought of our special guest, Nikole Hannah Jones. As we described our vision to Ms. Hannah Jones, she asked that we not just do a traditional keynote address, rather, she wanted to get in conversation with us, and we loved that idea. Tyler Garrett, Donnie Prather and I. Tyler Garrett, Donnie Prather and I will lead a moderated discussion. And all of you too will have an opportunity to ask questions of Ms. Hannah Jones. Before I introduce our guest, allow me to introduce myself quickly. My name is Natalie Kingshaw. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and I'm a sophomore majoring in psychology. I'm joined by Tyler Garrett and Donnie Prather, who are both graduate students in school psychology. Nikole Hannah Jones is a Pulitzer Prize winning creator of the 1619 Project and a staff writer at the New York Times Magazine. She has spent her career investigating racial inequality and justice and injustice, and her reporting has earned her the MacArthur Fellowship, known as the Genius Grant, a Peabody Award, two George Polk Awards, and the National Magazine Award three times. Hannah Jones also earned the John Chancellor Award for Distinguished Journalism and was named Journalist of the Year by the National Association of Black Journalists and the Newswomen's Club of New York. In 2020, she was inducted into the Society of American Historians, and in 2021, into the North Carolina Media Hall of Fame. She also serves as the Knight Chair of Race and Investigative Reporting at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. In 2016, Hannah Jones co-founded the Ida B. Wells Society for Investigative Reporting, which seeks to increase the number of reporters and editors of color. She holds a Master of Arts in Mass Communication from the University of North Carolina and earned her BA in History and African American Studies from the University of Notre Dame. So thank you so much again for joining us today. We're so excited, and I'm gonna pass it off to Tyler to ask the first question.
Hi, yes, thank you so much for being here today. So for our first question, we'd like to get to know more about your history and journalism. We wanna know what inspired you to go into the field of journalism, and had you considered other career choices before?
Hi, thank you, Tyler, and thank you, Natalie, for that introduction, and thank you, everyone, for joining the talk today and for holding this important symposium. You know, I was a pretty nerdy child, and I loved reading the newspaper with my dad. Some of the earliest memories I have, my dad was an avid reader, and he always subscribed to our local paper and our state paper, and some of my earliest memories are reading the newspaper with my dad, and I actually got my first letter to the editor published when I was 11 years old, way back in 1988. Jesse Jackson was running for president, and he did not do very well in the Iowa primary. And I thought that that had a lot to do with race. So I was an 11-year-old kid who was following the primaries, which is already weird, and then felt that I should write a letter to the editor about that, in which I predicted that we would one day have a Black president, so my fellow Iowans needed to get over it. So I think I really, from a young age, understood the power of narrative and telling our own stories. And as I was reading the paper, the only time Black people really appeared in our local paper was in the crime log. And yet I knew that that was not representative of our community. And in high school, I joined my high school newspaper, and I was bused to white schools as part of a school desegregation program. And I started writing about the Black kids like me at the school who were bused out of our neighborhoods and into this white school, and felt a lot of discrimination because of that. And that's when I really started thinking about journalism as a career. I kind of had three careers that I thought I might go into. I wanted to consider going into law and becoming a civil rights attorney. I thought about getting a PhD in history and becoming an historian. And then I thought about being a journalist. And ultimately, I chose journalism because I loved writing. I loved the research aspect of it, but also really felt that journalism could be a powerful tool for change, that historians write for college students who have to read history and nerdy kids like me who love history, but journalists actually write about what's happening right now. And journalists can change what is happening in our society while also studying history and helping use history to explain our world. So that's how I ultimately decided to pick journalism. But any point, even now, I would love to have been a civil rights attorney, and I would love to have been a historian.
Thank you for that. And thank you for being here as well. And so even going further into that too, like also as a journalist, why is it important for you to cover the topics of racial inequity and injustice?
So I'm not one of those journalists who just happens to be Black. My journalism is framed by being Black. I don't separate those two. I'm a Black journalist. The only reason I wanted to become a journalist was to write about Black folks, to write about racism. There's lots of other important journalism, but that's why I wanted to become a journalist. And it's important because anti-Blackness, racial inequality is foundational to the American experience, and there's nothing in American life that's not impacted by it. So when I was first starting out, I wasn't considered a race beat reporter, but it didn't matter what beat you put me on. I would write about racial inequality because it's everywhere. So if you're covering education, if you're covering government, if you're covering the environment, if you're covering policing, there's really nothing untouched by it. And I don't think that we can understand our society if we're not writing about it. And these, to me, racial inequality and the experience of Black people were some of the most pressing issues in our society. So there's lots of journalists of color who choose to cover a whole range of things, but that wasn't of interest to me.
Thank you so much for that powerful response. We have a question in the chat asking, during your research for the 1619 Project, what was the most difficult fact about our history that you uncovered?
I don't think there was, a lot of it was difficult, but there wasn't anything that was completely shocking to me. I've been studying this history for a long time, since I was a 16-year-old in high school. I majored in African American studies in college. If you look on my bookshelves, this is all I read is historical text. So there wasn't anything that surprised me. But I will say, I pitched the project the first week of February, it published in August, and spending every day for that entire period just reading about the barbarism, the atrocities, the human rights violations that Black people have had to go through, looking at photos of lynchings, photos of slavery, photos of police brutality. That was emotionally very taxing, but it wasn't surprising. I would say the most surprising thing that I learned in the course of doing the 1619 Project, which when I think about it was actually naive, but it's a shared naivete, which is how much slavery actually played in the American Revolution. And of course, that's been the most controversial claim in my essay, but it's been the most controversial claim because we have, as a society, really refused to grapple with the role that slavery played in our founding. Not just that a lot of our founders were enslavers, but that it was one of the reasons it motivated some of the founders, and particularly the Virginia and Southern colonies, to join the revolution. And that's just not something that any of us are taught, even those of us who have studied Black history, African-American history for a very long time.
Thank you. Before I get into my next question, there's another question in the chat. A couple more questions in the chat, but I'll just do one more for now. So what are your thoughts on the 1776 Project in response to your 1619 Project is one that came up?
Okay, I'm gonna assume that's a somewhat of a rhetorical question. And I'm also gonna assume you're talking about the 1776 Project and not the 1776 Commission. So the 1776 Project is, allegedly a Black conservative scholarly response to the 1619 Project. And then of course the 1776 Commission was convened by executive order by Donald Trump against the 1619 Project. So my thoughts on both of them are they're not worth my time. And there clearly was not the amount of scholarship or rigor or research or thoughtfulness that went into the 1619 Project. They're not a true refutation of the 1619 Project. Most of them, the 1776 commission actually had no historians on it whatsoever, no footnotes, no citations. The 1776 project is a bunch of opinion essays. it's not research. So I take it as a form of flattery that people are that worried about the power of the 1619 project and the reach of the 1619 project that they have to come up with projects to try to refute it. So the fact that it exists, just a badge of honor to me, but it's not to be taken seriously. Though I certainly welcome anyone to engage with those projects themselves and judge for yourselves. That's all I have to say about that.
Thank you. So my next question, you talked about how you studied African-American history in college. So one of the things that was like the first thing that I learned in an Africana studies class was the principle of Sankofa, to return and get it. So how has that principle applied to your work on the 1619 project and your identification of the year 1619 as the catalyst of American slavery?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the entire reason the 1619 Project exists is we as a society have not wanted to grapple with how foundational slavery was to the establishment of our country. And that even those of us, you know, Black Americans clearly know that slavery was an important and critical institution since it shaped every aspect of our lives. But the denial has been of the role that slavery has shaped our entire society. And the fact that every American child is taught about the Mayflower, a ship that lands on the eastern shore of what would become the United States in 1620. And yet no American child is really taught about the year 1619 and another ship called the White Lion, which was just as important, really speaks to that erasure. So how can we as not just Black Americans, but as a society actually understand ourselves, understand our institutions and understand the country. Sorry, y'all, I'm at home, that's my daughter. Understand the country that we live in if we're not going back and understanding that history. Now, we know that our society in general understands that things that happened in the past impact us, right? No one ever says, oh, the Declaration of Independence was a long time ago, so why are you still bringing that up? Or the Constitution was ratified in 1789, that was 200 years ago, why are you bringing that up? No one ever says that. But when it comes to slavery, we're always told that we need to move on, that that happened so long ago, that how could that impact our society today? And so to me, the argument of the project is all of these things shape our society. And you can't ignore some and hold up others if you truly want to understand the society that we live in. The history that we've all been taught doesn't explain the insurrection on January 6th. It doesn't explain George Floyd. It doesn't explain why Black Americans are at the bottom of every indicator of well-being in our country. That history we've been taught is a history of a country that doesn't actually exist. It's a history of a country we want to pretend we are versus the country that we are. So this project is trying to force us to really, really deal with what built our society in hopes that in finally being honest about what built our society, we can actually create a society that lives up to its ideals. So that erasure is just as powerful as the narratives we have been told. The narratives that we have not are shaping our society just as much.
Wow, thank you so much. So going into our next question, I myself have struggled with the intersectionality of being a Black woman and being an American in this country and seeing what this country has done to our people and other groups. And so my next question for you was, how would you explain your relationship as a Black woman with your country before and after working on this project?
Okay, Tyler, now that was a good question because, you know, a lot of people. So if you haven't read my opening essay for the project or listened to the opening episode of the podcast, I start with my dad flying this American flag in our front yard and how really conflicted and embarrassed I was that a Black man who was born in apartheid Mississippi would fly this emblem of a country that didn't treat us as citizens in the front yard. And by the end of the essay, I come to really claim ownership over that flag. And so a lot of people say, well, when did you come to understand your dad and his patriotism? And the answer is, as I was writing the essay, like literally 2 years ago, as I was researching this essay on democracy, and the opening essay really talks about how Black Americans have been the most democratizing force in our society, that while our founders wrote down these great words of liberty and freedom and the inalienable rights of men, they didn't actually believe them to be true for most Americans, but Black people read those words. And said, those words do apply to us. And we do believe in equality of men, and we're going to fight for that. And that's been the role that Black Americans have really played since the revolutionary time until now. So I was doing a lot of reading of texts that were written back then during the Colored People's Conventions, of speeches, of columns that were being written in Black newspapers and abolitionist newspapers, and seeing how Black people were refusing. So Black people were not citizens of this country. We were not considered to be citizens of the land of our birth. And it took the 14th Amendment to guarantee Black people citizenship. The Supreme Court ruled that Black people could never be citizens of the United States, whether enslaved or free, because we came from a slave race. So here we are in a country, the only country we've ever known, many of us, and yet we have no rights of citizenship or not recognized as citizens. But Black people, we're not going to be defined by how white people were choosing to define us. And Black people were saying, we are citizens, we built this country. Our ancestors' blood is in this soil. Our ancestors' bones are buried in this soil. This is our country as much as anyone's, and you won't tell us that we can't be citizens. And it was really thinking of the power of that, that people who many were enslaved, many had just come out of slavery themselves. There was a whole colonization movement that was saying that once freed, Black people needed to leave this country and go somewhere else. And Black people refused largely to engage with the colonization movement. It really just changed my understanding of America and helped me understand that us not claiming our citizenship, claiming our own country, is us actually forfeiting our legacy and forfeiting our inheritance that our ancestors really fought for. But that's different than a form of patriotism that says, I'm wearing my flag pin, this country can do no wrong, this is an exceptional nation and the best country in the world. That's clearly not true. That has never been true for Black Americans. But it's the form of patriotism and citizenship that says, those ideas that Thomas Jefferson, who owned 200 human beings, including his own children, when he wrote those words of the Declaration, we hold these truths to be self-evident. All men are created equal, endowed by the Creator with inalienable rights, that those words were majestic. And those words are actually worth fighting for. And that is the country that Black Americans have always tried to build. And that is really where that sense of ownership and patriotism and citizenship comes from. And that's the citizenship that my father was claiming with that flag. It wasn't, imperialist, colonialist, apartheid America, but it was the land that his fathers and mothers built, and saying, this is our country as much as anyone else who came after us, and no one has the right to make us feel that way. And I don't know where y'all are from, but one thing I think that has been different about the Black American experience compared to the experience of other people who also were enslaved in the Americas is that those other countries are majority Black countries. So when they come here, they proudly carry their Jamaican flag. They carry their flag from Trinidad. But we have been an oppressed minority in a majority white country. And so we have felt that we cannot claim the flag of our country. Jamaica's not their original place either. Their original place is Africa, just like ours. But they have the ability because they are a Black-run country and they feel that this is their identity. We've not had that ability, but we should. And we shouldn't actually cede that identity to white Americans to determine who is an American, who can claim this country, and who can claim citizenship. Now, I'm not going to ever fly an American flag outside my home. I'm not going that far, but I certainly believe we have the right to do it, and I understand why my father did.
Yeah, that was very powerful. And even like you mentioned in your essay too, I have you here, you said the truth is that as much democracy as nation has today, it has been born on the backs of Black resistance. And we know this throughout history, how Black people have been leaders and trailblazers in the fight for democracy. Even now we've seen in the elections and everything. So how do you see Black people continue to move that mantle forward today?
Yeah, I also say in that essay, there's something about people, no one values freedom more than those who have never had it. And that's been the role that Black Americans have played. We have had to fight for democracy because we were excluded. We had people legislating against us. We had people determining everything about our lives, from where we could live, where we could send our children to school, where we could shop, what jobs we could have. And so we had to play that role of being this country's democratizing force, of saying, you wrote these words down on paper, so you are going to be forced to live up to them. And we certainly, we are taught that we are the greatest, freest, most liberatory country in the world. And that's why the story of Black people and Indigenous people is so inconvenient to American mythology, because we're standing off to the side, kind of shaking our head like, no, we're not. Because in order to believe that, you have to erase us. You have to erase what was done to Black people. You have to erase what was done to Indigenous people. And so that's kind of largely how it was handled. And certainly in the story of American democracy, we've only practically been a democracy since 1965. It was not until the Voting Rights Act that all Americans actually had the ability to exercise the franchise, right? And yet we tell ourselves that our democracy started in the 1780s. It did not. What that means, though, is that our democracy is actually very young and very fragile. People had to die in an extended resistance effort to get the fundamental right to vote. And now, of course, all of us saw as we were watching and waiting for the election returns, whether Black people in these cities, Black cities that have been castigated by our society, looked down upon by our society, Detroit, Philadelphia, Milwaukee, Atlanta, whether they were going to save democracy once again, right? And they did. And now, of course, the punishment for that is a wave of voter suppression laws that are trying to go back to really what our founders set out, which is a country run by the elites, where white landed wealthy people are the legitimate actors in a democracy, and Black and brown and lower income people are not. So this has been long the role that Black people have played. The fact that despite all of this voter suppression, Black people still turned out in such high numbers, so much grassroots organizing in order to save an election when many white Americans were willing to suspend democracy as long as they were able to hold on to power. But I also want you all to think about when in your lives have you ever been told that Black people are the perfecters of this democracy? When in your lives have you ever been told, right, that our freedoms, not just as Black people, but the expansion of rights for women, the expansion of rights for Native people, for people with disabilities, even gay rights, when gay rights advocates go to the Supreme Court and argue that gay people have a constitutional right to marry, they use the 14th Amendment, which was pushed by formerly enslaved people to ensure equal protection under the law in order to make their case. So we are taught many things about Black folks, that Black people are a problem, that Black people are a drag on society, that Black people are criminal, but we are not taught that our democracy itself has hinged upon the freedom struggles of Black Americans, and that has actually been our role. So there's a power in reframing the way that we have been taught to understand ourselves, and also to understand that the way we have been taught to think about ourselves is intentional. It is not incidental, it's not accidental. All of the history that we talk about in the 1619 Project, we didn't create. That history exists, that history has been, that scholarship has been ongoing for decades. And yet we're not taught that in K-12, we're not taught that in popular culture. That's intentional.
Wow, thank you so much. There's a lot of questions in the chat, so I'm gonna ask a couple of those before I get into my next one. So one that came up is, How do you challenge and push forward the work of those who have come before you in your own work?
I understand that as a Black woman writer, I owe a tremendous debt. There's a reason my Twitter handle is Ida B. Wells. You wouldn't have a Nikole Hannah Jones without people like Ida B. Wells, without people like Ethel Payne, without people like Frederick Douglass. You just wouldn't, Simeon Booker, I wouldn't exist. So I absolutely study their work. I study their writing. If you ever want to be depressed as a writer or someone who fancies themselves an intellectual, all you have to do is read Du Bois or Frederick Douglass or Baldwin or Toni Morrison, and you realize that everything you could ever want to write, they've already written, and they wrote it better, and it still holds true today, right? So you have to study the writing of some of our greatest kind of intellectual powers, and always give homage to those who came before. When I won the Pulitzer last year, I won a Pulitzer on the same day that they gave a posthumous Pulitzer to Ida B. Wells. And I was crying like a baby. It was a complete surprise for me. And to know that all of these, a century after her death, that she finally got the acknowledgement that she deserved, I couldn't help but connect that to my being able to even do the type of work that I do. So I hope, I feel like the people in this group very much understand that we come from a very powerful lineage. And while we have to blaze our own trails, we always have to pay respect to those who came before us. My father was born on a cotton plantation in Greenwood, Mississippi. My grandmother was a domestic. So I don't feel a distance between that. Neither one of them even lived to see me work at the New York Times. And I have to spend my life really repaying the debt of what allowed me to get here. And I'm gonna tell one quick story that I really haven't talked about. When I first conceived of the 1619 Project, I really wanted one of the poets I really, really wanted was Sonia Sanchez. I just, she was a leader of the Black Arts Movement. She's just so powerful. And I felt it was important to include some of those poets who established our ability to do the type of writing, Black nationalistic writing, that many of us kind of engage in now. And she wasn't able to be in the first project, but she is going to be in the book. And I talked to her after I won the Pulitzer, and she said, "Sister, I just screamed when you won the Pulitzer, because James Baldwin never won the Pulitzer. I never won the Pulitzer. Toni Morrison never won the Pulitzer. And we all know it wasn't because they didn't have the talent and the brilliance to win it, but they couldn't win for doing something that Black back then." And I was able then, because of the work that they did, because of what they had to go through, to actually do something very Black, centered in the Black experience, and win the Pulitzer. Without them, it wouldn't have happened. And kind of having hearing that story of her pride was all the affirmation of the work that I needed. So I hope all of you, as you do your own work, that you cite Black scholars, that you cite Black orators, that you cite Black folks who have come before you, and really understand none of us would be in the positions, and we should never want to be the only one in any of the spaces that we're in.
Thank you so much for sharing that story. And that's really a great transition to another great question that was in the chat, asking what advice you have for students in this space whose social justice work doesn't always align with institutions of higher education. If you have any, I think what you already said could apply, but if there's any other encouragement as well.
I mean, I think you have to, so one thing about me is I'm not going to say anything through rose-tinted glasses, right? We already know that these institutions may say that they're welcoming of that type of work, but they are not. If you are doing truly radical work in your field, it's not going to be embraced, and you shouldn't have the expectation that it's going to be embraced. What you have to decide is what is most important to you. When I was earlier in my career, I was nearly driven out of journalism because I knew exactly the type of journalism that I wanted to do. I was going to do journalism about racial inequality and Black folks, and my institution did not value that journalism. And they told me I was biased. They told me that it was going to damage my career, but I didn't want to be a journalist to write about anything else. And if I couldn't do that journalism, being successful was not as important to me. And I had to decide. I had to decide whether my career ambition was worth me not actually being able to pursue the type of work that I morally felt that I was called to do. Luckily, me sticking to my morals really eventually paid off, but there's a lot of other journalists for whom it didn't, who were pushed out of the profession, who never found the type of success that other people have found, even though they had the talent. So I think you're all going to have to, at some point, grapple with that. The decision that I made was, if I had to lose myself to succeed, it wouldn't have been worth it. And I can honestly say I have arrived here without ever having compromised my values and my work, but I very well could have not arrived because I did that.
Thank you. Switching back a little bit to the 1619 Project, one of the quotes that really stuck out to me at the end of your essay was, Black people suffered under slavery for 250 years. We have been legally free for just 50, but free was in quotes. So I'm wondering, through the lens of the 1619 Project, what is your view on the modern day operation of the prison industrial complex and the historical implications of that?
Yeah, so when I say legally free, what I mean is, yes, we ostensibly have now, beginning, 1968 is when the first great civil rights legislation was passed, which feels like a long time ago, but that was less than a decade before I was born. And while I'm not as young as y'all, I'm not an old woman, right? So this is not ancient history. Hold on one second, y'all. My child is trying to get in the house. So when we understand that we did not gain full rights of citizenship until 1968, when our people have been on this land since 1619. And then that full rights of citizenship still includes certain provisions, certain discrimination that we all feel. If you guys have ever heard of a book called Slavery by Another Name, I know many of you have heard about the new Jim Crow, but Slavery by Another Name also just really shows the way that systems adapt in this country, that a country built on a racial caste system, on the forced economic exploitation of Black Americans, that just because you outlaw something legally, doesn't transform those systems. It doesn't make sure that those systems go away. And in fact, those systems become very adaptable. So at the end of slavery, you get convict leasing, and you get sharecropping, which isn't slavery, but it's not freedom. Then after the end, of course, of sharecropping and with the civil rights provisions, then we see the war on crime. We see the war on drugs. So we see these new policies that still serve to keep poor Black people confined, to keep poor Black people as free laborers in many ways. I just read a statistic the other day, one of three Black boys will be involved in the criminal justice system at some point in their lives compared to one of 17 white boys. So it's not that we have a system of slavery right now, clearly we don't. And one thing that white supremacy is able to do is adapt in ways where it says, okay, we can't have that exact same system. We can't enslave everyone anymore, but we can still have a version of that system that enslaves a significant number of people. Y'all about to see a Black mother moment on this thing right now. Oh my God. I can't wait till we can go back into an office and have these things in real life. So when we think about something like mass incarceration, or we think about the fact that once you serve your time, you're still not actually free. You can't vote in many states. You can't stay in public housing in many states, right? You are denied benefits having a drug felony is one of the only crimes that prevents you from ever getting a federal student loan. You can kill someone, be convicted of that, and still get a student loan to go to college. But if you have a drug felony, you cannot. We understand that these are racialized laws, that they don't have to say that they're racialized for them to have a racialized impact. And so that's why I put free in quotes, because one, there was never any real effort to address the 250 years of slavery and legal apartheid, simply saying, okay, now you all, after 250 years of not having equal rights, now you all have the same rights, so we're all equal, without actually doing something to address what that 250 years did economically, legally, educationally. That means that our freedom is not the same. And one of the things that Dr. King said, now not the Dr. King from that one line in the 1963, I Have a Dream speech, one, the whole speech is much more radical than that one line. And he lived five more years after that. And what he says, the 1967, 1968 Dr. King, is that those civil rights laws, that was the easy struggle, that the hard struggle, the struggle where he was going to lose white support, was around economic redistribution. It was about actually ensuring that Black people didn't just have legal rights, but had economic rights, because in a capitalist country, what good is it, he said, to have the right to go to a restaurant if you can't pay for the hamburger? You may as well not have the right. It doesn't do you any good. And that's really been the way that Jim Crow has continued to play out in our society, is the forced wealth poverty that Black Americans experience. So again, I'm just trying to, with that essay, with all of my work, trouble these settled narratives and the way that we have been taught to think about our society, to think about ourselves and our community, because I know all of us have gotten some question or statement where folks are like, well, Black people have the same rights as everyone else, so why aren't y'all just doing something with that? And we know that there's a reason, but we can't actually articulate what those reasons are. And I wanted this project to actually give us the language, the history, the data, to be able to actually articulate that this inequality that we experience is just as created as the inequality we experienced prior to 1968. I know my answers are long, y'all, I'm sorry.
No, we love your long answers. That was so powerful, thank you. So as some may know, the 1619 Project has been used to develop educational materials for students. So I was wondering, what would your best hopes be for changing the social studies, the way that social studies and history is being taught in primary and secondary schools going forward? And what implications do you foresee this curriculum having in education?
Yeah, thank you. I mean, we need to discard the entire current social studies curriculum right now. And I think it is important to understand, what is social studies curriculum trying to do? It's not actually trying to teach us the facts of what happened. This happened on this date, this person did it, and this was the impact. The social studies curriculum that we get in K-12 is a nationalistic curriculum. It is a curriculum designed to give us a shared sense of American exceptionality. So it necessarily plays up the good aspects of our society, and it downplays and erases kind of the failings, the contradictions, the violence, the brutality. It's not an accurate history. And it's really more towards trying to create this sense of propaganda about who we are as a country, and not actually helping us understand who we are as a country. So we would need to discard all of that, right? Like, how many of us have been taught that George Washington's teeth were made out of wood, right? They weren't. They were made out of human teeth. His teeth were the teeth of enslaved people that were pulled out of the mouths of people he owned. So how do we all have this understanding of something that's completely made up and that we take as fact? This is what so much of our history is. It's not the truth of what happened, but it's people who don't largely look like us deciding that this is the history we want to present to children, because this is how we want children to understand our society. So there's a great book, when I was a college student like y'all many years ago, called A Different Mirror by Ron Takaki. And it was a multicultural history of America that to me, succeeded much more in presenting a country, the narrative of a country that wasn't saying America was good or bad, but saying this is the country. And these are all of the different ways that different people of different racial groups have experienced this country and contributed to this country. We need something far more like that. But I think we have to realize, so the 1619 Project was turned into curriculum by the Pulitzer Center, and it is being taught in at least one school in every state in the country. And now there's been really a flurry of laws being introduced in state legislatures trying to ban the teaching of the 1619 Project. And what they're saying is the 1619 Project is a divisive history. It doesn't uplift American exceptionalism. And so that tells you that the battle is about who can control narratives, who can decide what version of America we're all going to learn, and that efforts to really transform K-12 curriculum to a curriculum that is more honest and reflective, there are a lot of powerful people with a lot of resources who will push back against that. There is understanding that history and narratives are about power. They're not about the truth. They're not about what happened. They're about power. And a lot of folks don't like that other people are now demanding some of that power.
Yes, thank you for that. And I wanted to kind of go into, you were discussing like data and articulating the 1619 Project. So even when you were doing your research, like what type of research, or if it's research methods or just research in general, did you find most crucial to developing that project, the 1619 Project?
So in some ways, the 1619 Project is a project I've been working towards my entire career. So the last two decades, I mean, I've been studying and reading and writing about these issues for more than 20 years. And when I pitched the project, I was really reliant upon all of those decades of scholarship that I had been reading, all of the scholars I've been reading to really guide us in where we were going to go. As a journalist, so I'm a long form journalist, and for much of my career I've been investigative journalist. I do original archival research. I look at data constantly. I read sociological studies. I read economic studies. I speak with scholars in all of those areas because you have to have a comprehensive understanding of these topics to really have a comprehensive understanding of the role that slavery and anti-Blackness plays in our society. So those are the same types of methods that I use for the project. One of the first things I did when I got the green light was I convened this big brainstorm session with scholars across academia, across fields, but who all have their work in the Black experience. And we just, you know, I told them the conceit of the project was to take things in modern American life that can be traced back to slavery in surprising ways. So what are something, you know, like tipping, for instance, which we didn't do an essay on, but I've always wished that we would. Tipping actually is a legacy of slavery. We're one of the only societies where people have to rely on tipped wages instead of an hourly salary. And that comes from the desire during slavery and after slavery for employers not to pay Black people wages, but to force them to work at the charity of the people whom they were serving. So we wanted a bunch of ideas like that, where things that would be surprising to people, but that scholarship could show could be traced back to slavery. And that group of scholars helped us come up with that. And then many of the scholars actually ended up writing those pieces and did that in, you know, using the scholarly norms. For my essay, I originally read about 15 books for that essay. And then we're revising, we have a 1619 book coming out this fall, and I have been revising my essay on democracy. And I read about 8 to 10 books just on the American Revolution. So all of those critics of that part, I'm definitely coming for them with a lot of scholarship and facts. So that's kind of my typical process, is I just read a lot. I talk to experts, I read as much data as possible, and then I somehow try to distill it down into a narrative story that people actually want to read.
Thank you. Kind of speaking about the previous work that you did and the impact that that had as you started the 1619 Project, what impact did your previous work focusing on the policies that maintain segregation in housing and education have when you were starting the project, and just your kind of inspiration and the context that you put it in as you started?
Yeah, so I've often joked long before I ever conceived of the 1619 Project that all of my work was trying to get us back to 1619. I've long believed that in our society, you can connect almost anything back to slavery, because slavery was such a foundational institution in this country. So a lot of my work, particularly in the last 10 years, was trying to prove that the architecture of racial inequality exists behind so much of our society, even if we ignore it, and that you could also treat racial inequality as an investigative beat. So I'm gonna get to your question. So when you think about the way you commonly see reporting on racial inequality, it's really just a listing of maladies, right? Black folks suffer from this. Black people are on the bottom of this, right? Black people have this the worst, as if it comes out of nowhere. There's no real explication or investigation of, well, why are these schools segregated? Is there a policy? Are there people making policy decisions that lead to segregated? It's not just incidental, but that's how we've tended to treat it. And so I have really tried to show the intentional architecture, policies, decision-making of people right now today, also in the past, but right now today who are doing that. And that's what so much of my school segregation and housing segregation work was not just saying Black people are the most segregated group of people in the country, but saying we're segregated because the federal government won't enforce the Fair Housing Act, because school boards gerrymander school districts to funnel Black kids into segregated Black schools. So that foundation was really critical in my thinking of kind of constructing the arguments of the 1619 Project. I don't know, sometimes when I ask college students if they've ever seen the movie The Matrix, everybody gets blank stares. So I don't know if y'all have seen the movie The Matrix or not, but if you have seen the movie The Matrix, I like to say that my work is like taking the red pill. So if you take the red pill, suddenly you see all of the coding behind the world that you've lived in. If you don't take that red pill, you can just go about your day and have no idea that someone's pushing all of these buttons, that your whole environment has been constructed. But once you read the work that I'm trying to do, the 1619 Project, suddenly you see that, oh, all of this was created. All of this was intentional. None of the conditions that Black Americans live in are just incidental, or because somehow Black people are the only people in the history of the world who just like living in poverty and don't like school and don't care about work. Like we inherently know, instinctually know that that's not true. But again, we haven't had the history, the policy. We haven't been able to get the type of education that allows us to make those connections. And so my work in housing, in schools, on criminal justice has all really been leading to the ability to do something much bigger like this and make these arguments across American life. I literally think if you name almost anything in society, I can trace it back to slavery.
So I think right now we would like to go ahead and open it up to the crowd. If you all have any questions, if you want to come off mute, you can go ahead and do that. Does anyone have any questions?
I do. I'm Rob Williams. I'm at San Francisco State University. I'm really happy to get a chance to speak my voice to you, but I'm finishing the book Cast by Isabel Wilkerson. I'm sure you're familiar with that, because I heard you use the word cast at some point. And it's a great book. How do you work with her in any capacity, and to what extent do you see your work overlapping with hers?
Yeah, so I love Isabel Wilkerson to death. she has also been really an inspiration for me. She was the first Black woman to win the Pulitzer Prize for journalism. The Warmth of Other Suns is my all-time favorite book, period. Anytime anyone ever asks me for a book recommendation, I always say The Warmth of Other Suns. And I also quite literally stalked her into becoming my friend. Every time she would come to New York to give a book talk, I would like show up and send her like Twitter DMs and ask her to coffee. And then finally she agreed. So I love her to death. And what I love is, so she's also a journalist and a lay historian. She knows how to report. She also knows how to research, but she also knows how to write. Her writing is some of the most beautiful writing I've ever told. And she has only ever wanted to anchor her work in the Black experience. So I can't give enough praise. Now, have I ever worked with her? No, and that's a bit of a sore spot for me because I begged her to be in the 1619 project, but she was working on cast and she couldn't, she was trying to finish her book. So I would love to have had her in the project. I had an essay that I really wanted her to write and I hope to work with her in the future, but I have not finished cast yet. I haven't been able to really do any reading outside of the reading I'm doing for the 1619 project book right now, but I'm very much looking forward to it.
I have a question.
My name is Larry Beck. I'm at San Diego State University. And to follow up on people who you either worked with or would hope to work with, I know that Ryan Stevenson is one of the people who contributed to the 1619 project. And I wonder if you could say a few words about his Legacy Museum and the National Memorial for Peace and Justice in Montgomery.
Yes, I am such a huge admirer of Bryan Stevenson and the critically important work that he's doing. In some ways, I really see him as being in the legacy of Ida B. Wells, in that when Ida B. Wells took up lynching as a cause, most middle-class Black people did not want to deal with lynching. They actually believed the stories of white Americans that Black people were being lynched, particularly Black men, because they were rapacious and brutalizing white women. And so they didn't really want to take this up as a civil rights issue. And so she really was determined to highlight the least of these, that even people who have been accused of horrendous crimes still are deserving of humanity and to be treated justly through the criminal justice system. And that's certainly Bryan Stevenson's work, right? To take people who have been placed on death row, and many of them, most of them, not people who are innocent of the crimes of which they've been convicted, and to say that they too are deserving of mercy and humanity. And as he always says, none of us should be judged by the worst thing that we've ever done, or summed up by the worst thing we've ever done. I just think that he's amazing in that way, in his heart and humanity, particularly for Black Americans, but for all marginalized people is so big. His museum there, you know, it's, he's a Harvard-trained lawyer who could be a millionaire right now, and really chose to go to Montgomery, Alabama, and advocate for the least of these, and to try to force a reckoning with the brutality and racial terror of lynching, and to force people to really grapple with that history, both through his museum, and he has, so I visited there a couple years ago. My father was from Greenwood, Mississippi. Mississippi lynched more Black people than any state in the country. And my dad's hometown of Greenwood lynched more Black people than any county in the lynching estate. And I got to see the monument he had there to my dad's hometown. And it absolutely took my breath away to see the number of Black people who were killed there. And so he's really trying to force us as a society to deal with the type of brutality that we just can't grapple with. And there's so much power in that. He believes, as I do, that there are many steps before you can have reconciliation. And the primary step is you have to own up to what we've done. We want to have reconciliation without the work. We want to have reconciliation without having to acknowledge the sheer terror that this country forced Black people to live under. The facts of lynching, when you read some of the accounts, and I've done quite a bit of research in lynching for some of the work that I'm doing, another book that I'm working on, when you see people skinned alive, people's body parts cut off one bit of a time. There was a lynching in Maryland that I researched where they killed this man, they dismembered him, and then they scattered his fingers and body parts on the lawns of Black people in the Black part of town to send a message to them. Like, we don't want to deal with that. And he's forcing the confrontation. And there's this great little story about, so he's in Montgomery, of course, Montgomery being the cradle of the Confederacy, but also was the largest kind of slave trading port in the Deep South. If you go to Montgomery right now, you can see all of these businesses that were engaged from Lehman Brothers on up that were engaged in the buying and selling of human beings. It was one of the worst places in America to be Black, and that's saying a lot. And when he got the permit to do his museum, he didn't tell them it was a lynching museum. They thought it was a civil rights museum. And once the town found out that it was going to be a lynching museum, they really tried to keep the museum from opening. So he kept it secret that whole time because they didn't want a lynching museum in the middle of Montgomery. And now it's actually one of the biggest tourist attractions in that city. I mean, what else are people going to Montgomery for, period? So I think he really speaks to that, the power of narrative, of shining a light in these very dark corners of our society that we don't want to deal with. But much more important than that, it really is the power of mercy that I think all of us in society should be trying to practice more of.
I have a question. My question is, what is your personal process while you're going through this? I mean, are you, as a researcher, are you experiencing, you know, from a social aspect, the internalization, the historical trauma, like grief, things like that? Because I'm collecting my mother's documents from Texas, and I never expected it to open up this can of grief. I didn't expect, you know, just getting birth certificates and death certificates and seeing how people died, where they were when they died, if they were separated from their family, things like that, that it would bring up this grief.
Yeah. I certainly never cried so much working on anything in my life. Those months working on the project, and really the months after the project published, were some of the most emotionally taxing of my career. I don't really know anyone who worked intimately on the 1619 Project, whether they were white or Black, who didn't cry at least once at some point in the process. We all know this history is hard and devastating, but to just spend day after day after day for months on end looking at the atrocities that your people face for no reason whatsoever, but also just the resiliency, the constant fighting back, the constant saying, you will not define our humanity. I felt such a tremendous pride to have come from the people that we've come from, but also just utterly devastated all the time. So I've talked about how leading up to the publication, I was definitely coping in ways that were not healthy. I was eating a lot, I was drinking a lot. I felt a really heavy burden on how do you do this 400-year story justice? How do you do justice to people who have been so dehumanized in our story? And it was not easy. And even now, I'm always reading about the things that this country has done to Black folks. And it's never going to be academic for us. It's not I close the book and I can move on. because I'm thinking about my own family members. I'm thinking about, you know, our ancestors. I'm thinking about my family who is dealing with incarceration right now. I'm thinking about, you know, my Uncle Ed who died because Black people are the most uninsured group of people in this country. Like it's never going to be abstract, and coping with that can be really challenging. And I think the one thing that, I don't know if it's used for or not, but the tool I always use is just to think about how blessed I am compared to everyone who came after me. And that even my hardest day is nothing compared to what even my father or my grandmother, and certainly not my great-great-grandparents, have had to go through. And so it's not easy, but it's a blessing. And I just try to keep that perspective, even as it can be really devastating.
Thank you for doing the work. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
We have a couple of questions in the chat, and I also see we have another hand raised. So we'll just do a couple in the chat and then call on the participants with hands raised. So Chris Wary, do you want to unmute to read your question from the chat?
Oh, sure. Thank you. I just wanted to say thank you very, very much. We used your work and Brian Stevenson's in our first year writing program in full, and it was just so helpful. And we plan to keep on using it going forward in our first year writing program. So thank you. And I'm really glad to hear you're producing more so we can kind of add and extend to it. My question, I guess, was back a little bit. It was about, you know, these reframings that you do in the 1619 project are just so powerful and productive. I was just wondering about discussions around things like reparations, whether you've found tactics or strategies that kind of help, I don't know, get into that area, which is, you know, so fraught and difficult, but also I think badly needed.
Yeah, thank you for that question. I actually wrote a cover story for the New York Times Magazine on reparations last year in the wake of the George Floyd protests. And I wrote that piece. I mean, one, I benefited from the fact that reparations has become less of a radical issue. Even 5 years ago, you couldn't bring this up in a presidential campaign or be taken seriously by mainstream society, if you were talking about reparations. And that's changed a lot because of organizing and a lot of writing. And I also think, you know, conversations around the 1619 Project that were really trying to show the legacy of slavery didn't end in 1865 with the abolition of slavery, that it shaped so much of the society that we live in. So when I wrote that piece, though, I set up in my head, what is every argument I've ever heard against reparations, and how can I find and outlay the facts to dispute it? It's one of those times where sometimes you're writing to different audiences, and I don't often write to, I guess I would say I don't often kind of, I usually write just what I want to write. But in this case, I write it very specifically against the arguments that I knew would come out. And I think that has proven to be very effective. The people who've actually read my essay, which you also know if you teach writing, that a lot of people don't read things even though they comment on them. But the people who actually read that piece said that they didn't know, right? And that all of these things we say that basically essentially argue Black people need to be bootstrappers, that Black people just got married and didn't have children out of wedlock and bought a home and got an education, that we could close the wealth gap. I just use all of the data available, the sociological and economic research, to really knock down those arguments one by one. And then I also just presented the history of how Black people tried to get reparations from the moment slavery ended and were never given that opportunity, and tried to build the argument around that. So it's one of those cases where I really benefited from having read so much other writing on reparations, having seen so many of the arguments against reparations, and being able to sit back having taken that all in and seeing what did I think was not effective and how could I build the most effective argument. And I think that's how we all have to kind of grapple with that issue. You have to take the emotion out of it, though you can't really. But I think when you just lay the facts out of what happened at the end of slavery, the 100 years of racial apartheid and terrorism that followed slavery, the fact that I'm the first generation of Black people born with full rights of citizenship in the United States, and that we've never seen an economic redistribution for those policies. I think when you lay that all out, it becomes very difficult to argue against it, but we don't often lay it out well.
Thank you. Makisha, sorry, I hope that's how you pronounce your name. Do you want to ask your question?
Yes, thank you so much. Thank you for hosting this event to SDSU. This is awesome. Great moderators. Ms. Nikole, thank you so much for being here and sharing with all of us, giving of your time. I wanted to ask you, and I apologize if you answered this already. We know that music is such a great part of our history, dating back to our ancestors in Africa, and music has always been used as a way for us to communicate. I wanted to know just what are some of the music that has inspired you or that you've used as you're doing this project? Like what gets you jumping? What motivates you? What type of music?
Oh, that's a question I haven't gotten before. So, oh, I don't even know if I should be honest. I really love like ratchet music. So I listen to, you know, depending on the mood, I'm either listening to like contemporary hip hop, or I listen to a lot of 90s, of course, because I'm old. I listen to, somebody said this the other day that like the 90s is now to you guys' generation what the 60s were to mine. I was like, damn, that's actually true. So I am old. Most of my writing, I try to channel a sense of anger and outrage. And so I listen to music that meshes with that spirit. I love protest music, whether it's protest music from the past, or I think a lot of hip hop today is protest music too. So that's it.
We also, in the last couple minutes, we had a question in the chat from Kat. Sorry, I hope I'm pronouncing everyone's names correctly. Please let me know if not. Ringenbach, if Kat, you'd like to unmute and ask your question.
You actually got my name right. Awesome. So you did touch on this about, the emotional labor that went into the project. And I was just curious of like, what would you recommend to the young students as they're moving forward into this difficult work on how to handle the emotional labor that this is going to bring to their lives?
Yeah, that's a good question. Though I don't know that I'm a good person to give advice on this, because I don't know that I have found the healthiest ways to deal with it. And I actually, until very recently, when people would ask me questions about self-care, I always felt that was like such a superficial question. Like, again, thinking about what our ancestors have been through, I work at the New York Times. My life is not hard, even though the work might be emotionally taxing. And then a very good friend of mine really put it in a way that I was unable to really understand or grasp before. And he was like, Nikole, like, you can't do this work if you're not here. So if you are like letting this work kill you, the stress of it, not taking care of yourself, like carrying that burden, you won't be here, and you actually have robbed your people of the work that you're trying to do. And it was in understanding that, in realizing that self-care is not actually being selfish. It's not superficial. It is a necessary part of the labor we do. There's a reason so many of our great kind of fighters and thinkers don't live into old age because of the emotional burden of the work that they're trying to do. So I would say that our work is often spent in suffering, but it doesn't have to be suffering. And you need to find your people whom you can talk to, whom you can vent, stop holding that in, take the time to take breaks from the work, which can be very hard when you feel like this is your purpose. And also understand that, and we know this, but I don't think we intellectualize it enough. All of Black life in this country has not been suffering, right? Like we find our joy. We have always found our joy in cooking and family and music and church and reading and dancing. And we need to realize that out of all of the things that our people have been through, we are strong, we are here, and we have amazing resilience, and we need to find that joy and relish in that joy. But how you do that, I don't always know, but you don't have to feel guilty about taking that time just to feel that joy. And surrounding yourself sometimes by people who, you know, you don't have to explain yourself to. You don't have to, they just know. Surround yourself by people who just know. Like if someone did something to you and you think they might've done it to you because it was Black, there are certain people you don't have to explain or justify it to. You could just fit. Surround yourself with those folks.
That was so beautiful, thank you. So before we head out today, we have one more question. I wanted to ask you, what advice would you give to a student that doesn't believe that their voice matters or that they're not able to make a difference in the field of research?
I mean, all of us matter, right? We all have a perspective and understanding and a gift. I think what is important is don't compromise yourself and stop judging yourself and your contributions based off of what other people are doing. That to me can be the most crippling thing. Is I remember, you know, I was an older graduate student. I was an older intern. I was working two jobs until I was 30 years old. I had a master's degree and was selling mattresses on the side while I was trying to make it as a journalist. And I would constantly look at other people my age or in my cohort, and they seem to be doing so much better than me. They seem to be finding so much more success than me. That is not useful. It's not a useful comparison. Was I working the hardest that I could work? Was I doing everything that I could do? That's all that we can control, is ourselves and our own excellence. So I would just say the difference you make shouldn't be based off of some exterior idea of what is success and what is important. That has to be based on your own values and your own work. And you have to really, I know it's hard, try to stop comparing yourself to other people and their journey. It took me longer to get where I am than some other folks, but I got here when I was supposed to get here.
Well, thank you so much for being here today. I know that each and every single one of us has something to take away from your message today. It was so beautiful, so powerful, and I learned so much just from being here. So thank you. I can go ahead and hand it off to Kiara, who's going to announce what's next.
Yes. So again, thank you, Ms. Hannah Jones, for coming in today and sharing all of your wisdom. We will be having a brief intermission before we commence into our afternoon program. We have a break until 12:30, and then you can meet us back in this main room for our afternoon performances.
Three, four. There's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. with brutality. Talk to me, honey, so you can see how what's going on.
Lifeless like me, miss you on your side of the bed. I still got your things here, there. Stay with me like souvenirs. Don't wanna let you out my head. Just like the day that I met you, the day I thought forever. You said that you left me, that'll last forever. It's cold outside, like when you walked on my life. Why you walk on my life? I get like this every time. On these days I feel like you and me, heartbreak anniversary. Now remember every time. On these days I feel like you and me, heartbreak anniversary. Do you ever think of me? Oh, no, no, no. I'm building my hopes up like presents unopened till then. Still see the messages you read. I'm foolishly patient. I can't get past the taste of your lips. Don't wanna let you out my head. Just like the day that I met you, the day I thought forever. You said that you loved me, but that'll last forever. It's cold out. Like when you walked in my life, why you walk in my life? And I can like this every time. On these days I feel like you and me, it's a heartbreak anniversary. Oh, I remember every time. Do you ever think of me?
For Kennedy, that was beautiful. Thank you for sharing your wonderful voice. And next up, we have the SDSU Dive.
She's a runner, she's a track star. She gon' run away when it gets hard. She can't take the pain, she can't get scarred. She hurt anyone that gets involved. Don't wanna commit, but take it this far. She gon' do the race, just not this one. Love is a game you used to cheer for. When I was down to talk, you weren't here for. You boom, boom, boom. Leave a trail of heartbreak and heartache like it cool. I guess way too late is convenient for you. The dirt you left don't turn into dust, it don't move. It's been waiting for you. Girl, you're killing me, you're tweaking all. I ask you what you feeling, you don't speak at all. But you go straight to Twitter, you gon' tweet it all. You must want another nigga to be alone.
What you want to see?
We was supposed to fight, I ain't through the storm. You made a decision, chose the easy one. Say you follow in your heart, but girl, you leaving one. Wanted me to take you back with open reaching on.
And I can't do that, mom.
Lost for words, let it hurt.
Setting my heart on fire, setting my heart on fire.
Put you first, show you your worth.
Give you whatever you desire, give you whatever you desire.
She's a runner, she's a track star. She gon' run away when it gets hard. She can't take the pain, she can't get scarred. She hurt anyone that gets involved. Don't wanna commit, but take it this far. She gon' do the race, just not this one. Love is a game you used to cheer for. When I was down to talk, you weren't here for.
All right, let's give it up for SDSU Diamond. Always love to see them dance. They do a wonderful job every time. And our last performer is our very own Sierra Watkins. Sierra is a sophomore majoring in theater performance, and she is an HDS academic coach, an HDS 2.0 scholar, and the vice president of Black Renaissance. And she is also a member of the SDSU Diamond, so you just have the pleasure of watching her in the video. And Sierra will be singing Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
Somewhere over
you.
Thank you, everyone. And thank you to all of our performers. Everyone was excellent. And next on our agenda, we have a video submitted by Dr. Nee Coker, Director of the School of Theater, Television, and Film, entitled Unauthorized.
My poor little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream. The bigots are out there with their weapons too. Yes, they're aiming just to gun down our children. So let me tell you this time around.
Yes, this time around.
Yes, we're gonna draw against this flag right now.
Draw this flag right now.
Our common goal is to stand our ground. Shoot, I put my hands up.
Should I
keep my mouth shut? What do you want from me?
Don't shoot,
got my hands up. Don't shoot, I put my hands up. Choking, I can't breathe. Should I run away? Statistics to the system. All kinds of crazy shit ran through my mind. Will I live to raise my children? 'Cause I'm gonna tell you this time around.
Yes, this time.
What goes around surely comes around.
Goes and comes around.
Is this defiance that's got me down? On lockdown. Don't shoot, got my hands up. Don't shoot, I put my hands up.
Should I
keep my mouth shut? What do you want from me? Don't shoot, got my hands up. Don't shoot, I put my hands up.
No doubt.
Hey, I'm choking, I can't breathe. Hey, I'm choking, I can't breathe. Down on my bending knees. Should I run away? Is it because I'm napping? Why is it chicken happy? Is it because I'm napping? Why is it chicken happy? Is it because I'm napping? Why is it chicken happy? Don't shoot.
Thank you for that powerful video. And thank you again to each of the wonderful, wonderful performances. So this afternoon workshops will begin promptly at 1 o'clock. So the 1 o'clock to 1:30 workshops are, and I'm sorry for mispronouncing your name, Adana McCarthy et al. With self-actualized Black graduate students, we have Idara Eason et al. And the African American Pledge of 2 years later. Then from the 1 to 2 p.m. Sessions are Mary Taylor with Black Student Success in Higher Education. Then we have the BLMA, Surviving and Thriving at PWIs, a Photo Voice exhibit. We also have Nicholas Lacey with Black Men's Mental Health and Law Enforcement. And we also have Sureshi Jawardeen, Ceylon Africans Keep the Memory of Their Ancestors Alive Through Song and Dance, and the Associated Students, Black Students, President's Panel. And then from 2 to 2:30 p.m. sessions are Kayla Daniels, Black Women's Visual of Radical Uplift in the Late 19th Century America. And we also have Larice Diamond, titled Clicks to Diversity and the Black Renaissance, which is the creation of the Black Renaissance Group. And then from our 2 to 3 p.m., we have sessions with Dr. Green and Aisha Jones, the who, what, and why now, because Black students still matter. And again, we have Nicholas Lacey with Black Students' Experiences in Higher Education at a PWI. So please locate the breakout rooms at the bottom of your screen, join the workshop, and we have some time too, as well, but join the workshop of your choice. If you join a 30-minute session, feel free to join the one-hour session when your session concludes. And then we'll meet back in the main session at 3 for our final performance and closing remarks. Thank you.
Awesome, so we're gonna wait one more moment for everyone to join back to the main session. Awesome, everyone. Welcome back. We hope that you all have enjoyed the afternoon of workshops. Our final performance spotlights the brilliance of our Henrietta Goodwin scholars. Each scholar will be performing an individual original piece. First up, we have Taylor Moore, who is a first-year student majoring in business administration. Without further ado, I would like to introduce Taylor to share her piece.
Hi. So this piece is called Story Rewrite. Cheese, click, he smiled with his rotten teeth. This guy was in no way, shape, or form camera shy. I looked at him straight in his eyes and I could see that he was glad that he said this to me. That's some nigger shit. He kept yelling and yelling. He wanted to make sure I felt below him. He walked past me and put down his mask. like he had no clue what I said. Welcome in, sir. Sir, can you please put on your mask? He walks in without a mask and looks dead at me. That story was written like that, not because that's in the order of events. It's actually backwards. It was written like that because as a woman of color, my story is always told backwards. They tell about my climax and not about my rise. They see the anger and aggression, but not what caused it. They don't see themselves following me and my friends around the shoe store. They see us calling them out on it. They don't see them calling the police on me for playing in the pool. They see me refusing to leave. Our story is always told backwards. So yes, I am angry. If an angry Black woman is what I have to be, then so be it. Because I refuse to sit back and smile about something that attacks my heart every day. I refuse to look in the mirror and look at someone who bows down to constant oppression. I had that moment in my life. I had that moment where I let my non-Black friends say nigga. I had that moment where I let people say I have big lips and big nose. I had that moment to be ignorant, but now I've realized I have a voice. And if I lose friends and family because they haven't found their voice, then so be it. Because boy, one day will they look back and they will have regrets. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you, Taylor, for sharing your individual piece. Next up, we have Melvin Ridley. Melvin is also a first year student majoring in political science.
Hello, can you guys hear me? Perfect. All right, this is my oppression and resilience statement. I am hardworking and intelligent. I'm unique and I will never be the same as anyone else. I am fully capable of completing any task or job given to me to the highest level. I will not succumb to the stereotypes that call me dumb, lazy, incapable, and tell me that all I do is wait around and let others solve my problem. I will not let the constant killings of my brothers and sisters frighten me, rather use that anger as fuel. I will never let the statements of my peers intended to degrade me make me feel that I am any less than they are. I will never let the words of others determine how far I can go. I am resilient because I will always work hard and will never settle for mediocre. I am resilient because I embrace my flaws and differences. I am resilient because I do not let others determine my worth. I have already proven to myself that I am enough. Now I will prove the haters wrong. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing. And you're right, you are enough. And finally, we have another first year student, Adkonya Sola Adewu Yi, who is majoring in computer science.
Hello, so I'm presenting my poem called Afraid. For so long, I had been afraid. Afraid to speak, afraid to be different, afraid to be myself. I was afraid to speak because I don't want to be too loud, because being loud is bad. It's ghetto. It's not very ladylike. It makes you look angry. And I refuse to be just another angry Black woman. I was afraid to be different. Being different was bad. It made people notice you more. It made you stick out. I was already known as the African girl, the one who was tall and ate weird food and had different hair and spoke differently, fast and with a stutter and with a weird, indescribable accent. The one who had that weird long name that nobody could pronounce. The one with a huge personality that was always happy and talkative. I was afraid to be myself because I was already so different. I just wanted to fit in. So I changed my hair. I started to walk in a way that made me look small and started to eat school lunch. I forced myself to watch YouTube videos so that my accent wouldn't be as strong. And I changed my name so that they could pronounce it. I toned my personality down so it could be more acceptable. But I was still different, still called African booty scratcher. So day by day, I made myself just a little bigger. I made my Blackness so visible they would have to accept it. I wore my hair big and natural. And on Cultural Acceptance Day, I showed up in a huge Ankara dress and I even wore a gele. I started to pack my lunch again and bring my native food again. And I realized that I will never change who I am, that I am Adekonya Sola Boluwatife Adewu Yi. That this is how God made me and I will never change myself so that society can accept me because I am enough and I'm no longer afraid.
Thank you. Awesome, thank you. Thank you all so much for sharing your pieces. Again, these are all first year students who are sharing their pieces. So that is super powerful and that deserves a huge HGSES. And so Thank you. And so to close our program today, I'd first like to thank our Black Research Symposium Planning Committee, Eric Bratton, Tyler Garrett, Natalie Kingshaw, Kiara Prack Perry, Donna Prather, Sierra Watkins, and Yasmin Shedd. In addition, I'd like to have a big thank you to our IT department, who not only assisted us with the initial setup, but they were also here all day assisting us with the breakout rooms, Edgar Hodges and Yustafa Levy. So in 1978, Maya Angelou admonished us to embrace the Sankofian principle of reaching back and getting it. This includes acknowledging and honoring our past because it gives us the fortitude and passion to move forward. She writes, out of the huts of history's shame, up from a past that's rooted in pain, we are a black ocean leaping and wide, welling and swelling, we bear in the tide, leaving behind nights of terror and fear into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, bringing the gifts that our ancestors gave. We are the dream and the hope of the slave. We rise. So thank you all again for joining us today. We're humbled and honored to showcase the brilliance and intellectual acuity of our Black scholars and student performers. Black people personify every gift that our ancestors gave, but our work is far from done. The body of work that you heard and are witnessed today illuminates the importance of and value of Black scholars working in Black communities to improve the lives of Black people. Our Henrietta Goodwin Scholar Affirmation implores us to persist, persevere, and to not give up. Lean in, ask questions, and support one another. We certainly did that today. We look forward to expanding this conference next year. And if you have any time today at 3 p.m., please support our African American Alumni's chapter in the renaming project for Dr. Shirley Weber at the University Senate meeting today at 3 p.m. And I will go ahead and drop our link in the chat. So if you're free today at 3 p.m., there's the Senate meeting. But yes, without further ado, always end our Black Resource Center programs with our signature song.
Coachella. Boots with the ghost feathers. I brought the squad with me. Black on black bandanas. I say it's champagne. I did the damn thing. Dirty Diana. Singing and dancing all in the rain. Ooh, I just wanna have a good time. Turn around, dip inside. And twirl that ass to the right. Drop, pop, cross your legs, turn around and clap, shuffle to the left, let's glide now. Ooh, drop it down, low, 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 low to the floor. Bring it up, Captain Roll. Step on them, step on them, step on them, step, step on them, kick on them, stomp and you step. Swag the right, surf the left, work the middle till it hurt a little.
Thank you.